Hello, hello, and welcome to the pre-show. Now, we have found an Nkuruma. The sniff of an Nkuruma. We've just spotted her moving through the bush opposite us, but unfortunately she is still north of the boundary. I'm just trying to see if she's going to pop out into the open. Oh, where is she gone now? Oh, they're still there. VM, can you get a gap through that quarry? Let's just have a look. Okay, let me just bear with us. I think it's a little bit there. Okay, there. So a little bit. Yes. Oof, so difficult. There's another one moving. Let's try from through there to the right. VM, sorry. And there. Okay, a little bit to the left. A little bit more. There. So behind that bushy there somewhere. But it's very difficult. Which is, they might be heading out to pop out into the open area. In around Sydney's waterhole. Maybe it's hot thirst. It's going to send them for a drink. Let's try a little bit further forward. Have they just done the lion flop again? They stood up to change positions because it was hot, and they've done the lion flop. Okay, I'm going to just go check right down towards the open area. Maybe they've popped out. VM and I myself, we just wanted to check exactly where they were for later on tonight, and hopefully they're going to come back into Juma. Let's see, no sign of them coming out in the open. But VM and I are going to go to Arethusa today. Haven't been there in a while, and see what's crack-a-lacking in the west. Here we go, man on a tractor. Oh yeah! Minjan! Vogi! Nkom! The only thing out on the open is a lady waterbuck miles away, and she's jogging off. Why are you jogging off? Is there a lion about to pop out? That is the question. That is the question. Yeah, kitty, 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 kitty. Yeah, kitty, kitty, kitty. No, I don't think that's going to work. Do you think that's going to work, Vim?
No, it's probably going
ksks. Oh, ksks. Apparently, Vim says when calling cats, one must go ksks. Final control, they can't hear you. Final control is going ksks, 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 ksks in my ear. Okay, we'll do one little gander. I think it's going to be better to come here later on when it's a bit cooler. They might stretch their legs across the open plain at Sydney's waterhole, and fingers crossed they come back to Juma. Rex, I've just had a visual of one on site where your Morven Konzo goes off opposite Sandy Patch, moving slightly to the west, towards the Mati. There we go, just telling Rex, and he's on his way to look for them. Okay. Well, where are you hiding? Where was it, Vim? Was it further forward? It was here somewhere where we spotted that line. I'd look for that.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
We have some Egyptian geese coming down to drink at a waterhole on this very hot afternoon. Welcome, this is Safari Live.
Ready.
afternoon again, everybody, and welcome on Safari Live, and to a beautiful warm afternoon with these Egyptian geese coming down to drink. It is really, really warm, and we have just stopped at a waterhole to see what animals are possibly coming down to drink. No sign of any animals at the moment, just the bird life. So some Egyptian geese, there were some guinea fowl earlier that just moved off. But it is a lovely, lovely afternoon on our sunset safari. And my name is Byron, and on camera with me this afternoon is Jandre, and we've got Brent and VM out on the other vehicle. You may have seen them already. And then on bushwalk we have got Jamie and Herbert and Eggsy a little bit later. You'll probably see them. And then also a big welcome to obviously the ladies in final control, or I like to call them the voices in my head. So Jerry and Rebecca, and then a big welcome to Providence Elementary. Lovely to have you little kids with us on our safari. Please don't forget to send us your questions. Ask your teacher either with Twitter at hashtag Safari Live, or email us questions@wildearth.tv, and we'll gladly answer them for you. Lovely to have all of you with us. We are going to see what we can find this afternoon. Now, Brent was trying to look for the female lions and the pride, the Unkahuma pride. Our plan this afternoon is we're going to try and find two male lions. Now, we did find them this morning. They were around this morning. So we're going to head into that same area, and I'm hoping, because it was a very, very warm day, that those male lions are resting and possibly in the same area. So let's have a look. We're not too far from where they were. Don't forget, everybody, we are completely live now. So whatever we see, you are seeing back home, maybe just a few seconds later than we find it. So this is very exciting. And I want to scan very carefully while I'm driving. I don't want to miss any sign of these lions. And what I'm looking for is probably these males lying in the shade of some trees, because it has been so warm. So maybe we get lucky and we do find them in the shade somewhere. There's a little warthog, everyone. Let's see if we can show it to you. I don't want to move too much closer. It might run off. Well spotted, Jandre. A little warthog. Look at that. And look at those beautiful big tusks. And the warthogs will use that to protect themselves. So if any predators do try and hunt them, they may turn and use those tusks, try and chase the predator away. And I have seen footage of warthogs turning and chasing, trying to chase lions, but generally they would probably try and run away. Lions are very, very powerful predators. So if there were any lions in the area, I doubt this warthog would just be wandering around. Let me see if I can get a little bit closer. It seems relaxed. Let's see if we can maybe get another little view of this warthog. And still just having a look around. You never know. These lions could be in this area somewhere. Oh, yeah, we're going to have a lovely view. Oh, thought so. Hang on. Maybe through here. Seems to be hiding from us at the moment, just through some trees. Can you get it through there, Jandre? How's your view? There we go. We are very, very fortunate to have the camera, and that we can zoom in. So even though I might not necessarily be able to see the warthog very clearly, we can still show it to all of you. And this little warthog looks quite curious. Now, everyone, this is actually a female. Oh, there she runs. Evan asked if I enjoy looking for animals. I definitely do. And I think it's very, very exciting because we don't know what we're going to find. So we're driving around and we're looking for specific little signs of animals that may have moved through the area. We try and listen out for them. It is very exciting to be able to look for these animals while we're on safari. That little warthog has just run off through the bush now. It's disappeared. It was just out of our sight. It was a little female and I could tell, and I was hoping to show you, but it ran away before I could. On the warthog's face, and the reason why they're called warthogs is because they do have these very prominent warts on their face. These two, or for the females, they've got two warts, and the males actually have four, two at the top and two at the bottom. And that's to protect their faces too if they do fight with one another. Okay, we are going to... You never know, we could bump into leopards too. And we're going to carry on looking for lions. And let's head to Jamie, who's out on a bushwalk this afternoon. She wants to say hello.
And a very good afternoon and welcome to the on-foot portion of the Sunset Safari. And most especially, a very warm welcome to all of the students at Providence Elementary. It's lovely to have you on board and I hope you're really, really excited for all of the things we can show you. Now, my name is Jamie and this afternoon, the man standing behind the camera is... Well, his name is Xander, but we call him Eggsy. I'm still not entirely sure why we call him Eggsy, but we call him Eggsy. Now, of course, we're out on foot, which means it gives us an opportunity to see even the smallest of things. Now, I've walked a lot in the bush, and I've walked into things like lions and elephants and buffalo and all sorts of the big animals. And, of course, it's really, really important that we concentrate and we make sure that we don't suddenly take ourselves by surprise and say, not watch ahead of us. So we always, if you watch us, we're always looking ahead of us, scanning the bushes, looking for anything that might be there. Because we don't want to walk in, this is the animal's home. Imagine if I came up to your home and walked into your personal space like that. Imagine how comfortable you'd be. But some of the animal that's hiding, hopefully, I'm hoping it's still there, just behind this bush. And I'll tell you exactly why. I want you to imagine that you're walking through the bush, you're concentrating really, really hard on not walking into anything that's going to surprise you, like a buffalo or perhaps a lion. Where's it gone? Is he? Did it manage to escape? No, it's he's going to come out to your side. I don't want to scare him, but I want to show you the animal that has given me the most big frights in all of my life in the bush. Come on, mister. I'm not going to walk too close to him because otherwise he's going to fly away. So this, there he goes. Here we go, Eggsy. You can see him here. This particular type of bird is called a Franklin. And specifically, it is a Cokey Franklin. Now, the reason I couldn't see him a little bit earlier is because their camouflage is so, so good. In other words, those patterns on his body, the patterns of his feathers, see how it goes brown and light and brown and light, and then his slightly orange head, which tells me that it is a boy Franklin, not a girl Franklin. Now, Franklin are really good at making sure that they are hidden away if there's something scary coming. So maybe something like a leopard, or perhaps a serval or a wildcat. They're good at hiding. And what that means is that they stay completely still until the predator is right up next to them. Now, even though I'm not a predator, I don't mean to hurt this Franklin. He is, of course, a little bit scared of me, so I'm not going to go up any closer to him. He's relaxed nicely while we've been standing here. But just imagine you are walking through the bush and you are tiptoeing, carefully looking, making sure that there's nothing waiting to jump out and startle you. And then all of a sudden, the next minute the bush goes, blah, flap, 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 flap. And you stand there like this. I promise you, of all of the times I've worked in the bush, 80% of the frights I have got have either been from those birds or from something known as a warthog, which I think Byron was showing you earlier. Now, those are the animals that tend to give us the biggest scares out here. Now, I want to show you something else as well. Isaiah, you wanted to know if we see many kinds of beetles on the bushwalk, and we're going to go make our way to something that Herbie has found around for us a little bit earlier. Yes, we see lots and lots of beetles. I'm looking for you as we walk along. In particular, there's something called a dung beetle, which we see all the time. But we see all kinds of amazing insects, and this is what I wanted to show you here. Because being in the bush is not always about the little things. It's also, I mean, the big things. It's also about the little things as well. Now, Herbie's job is to walk ahead of me because I'm talking to you. Sometimes I'm turning my back and I'm walking backwards. So Herbie's job is to make sure that he walks ahead of us and make sure that the area in front of us is safe so that we don't startle any animals. Now, what I wanted to show you is here, somewhere. I wanted to show you some of the small insects that we see, and just watch them for a moment. These are harvester termites, and they're busy harvesting, and just watch the way that they work. All of these sticks here have been gathered. Look at this guy. Look at him over here, trying to pull it into underneath the ground. Look how strong these creatures are, all working together. That's a big stick, mister. That's not going to go in the hole properly. Oh, it's going. It's going. So they work in the most incredible teams. You can see the termites coming out, rushing off, going to search for things to collect. And then the other workers are inside the hole, helping to break down the big stuff, like this huge stick that the one guy bought. He's definitely an overachiever. Here comes a blade of grass. And look quickly at the difference in the size of these as well. Here's a really big one. Here's another really big one. Here's a tiny little one rushing to bring grass back to their home. And this, of course, is for them to break down and to feed on. Aren't they incredible? So that's what this bushwalk is all about. It's not just about the big things, it's about the little things as well. But the big things are also very exciting, and I'm sure all of you would love to see a big male lion. While I hear that Byron has got one, let's go and have a look.
We do. Look at this, everyone. We found these male lions. Ah, they are so beautiful. And just as I thought, they are lying in the shade of those little trees behind them, the gwari trees. They're called gwari trees. And they are resting for the day. Now, why the lions are resting, and as I said earlier, it is a very warm afternoon. And the lions are lying in the shade. They are saving their energy for later. They're most likely going to get up and start moving a little bit later, probably when it starts getting dark, as the temperature starts cooling down. And then these males will most likely move quite a distance. And what they do is they mark their territory. And if we're lucky, maybe later we might even hear them roaring. But I'm not sure, it all depends, possibly tonight, maybe late this evening we might hear them roaring from camp. Look at some of the scars on that lion's face. Now, lions can get a bit aggressive with each other. And it's usually when they are feeding that they may get a bit aggressive with each other. And Kaylin, you want to know, what do lions eat? So Kaylin, the lions are the top predator in this whole area, and they will eat just about anything. So anything from a small little antelope, so a impala, and we'll hopefully show you some impala a little bit later, all the way up to larger antelope, a wildebeest, perhaps even a zebra, sometimes giraffe, and some lions have even been known to hunt elephant. Obviously an elephant's very big and powerful, but if the lions are successful hunters and experienced hunters, they do try something like that. And these lions lately have been enjoying buffalo, and they've been eating buffalo. Olivia, you want to know why the little, or why the manes, not little, why the big lions have these puffy manes. So Olivia, for these males, and it's only the male lions that have the manes, and the reason for that is because it protects them. So we saw on that male's face, that one over there, you could see the scratches and all the scars from fighting with one another. And the mane around the head is to protect the neck and the head in case another lion tries to bite him when they do fight. So that is to protect themselves. It's also to look very pretty for the females. The males with the big, beautiful manes are sometimes more dominant, and they can then attract females. Holt, you have an interesting question. You want to know, why is it called a pride? Holt, I don't know. I really don't know. Good question. As long as I can remember, lions, a group of lions, have always been known as a pride. And certain names have been given to some animals depending on the group. I don't know. My theory would be possibly because a lion signifies unity, with a pride or a group working together. So they're very proud lions working together, and maybe that's where the name pride comes from, of a group of lions. But I don't know. It's a very good question. And it's been around for many, many years, that name. Now, it's not that scary when we find the lions. Evan, you don't have to worry. We think that these lions are not that interested in us, so we don't get that scared. And we are very careful, though, Evan. So when we do look for lions, and if we are trying to view them, we do still give them a bit of space, so we don't cause them to feel unhappy, or what we say is threatened. We don't want them to feel unhappy, so that they don't react to the vehicle or react to us. Now, we are on a vehicle, so we're on a car, and it's a bit easier for us to get closer to them. If we were walking, it would be a very different story, and these lions would most likely react to us, possibly sit up and maybe even growl at us. So we do still have to be very, very careful, and we respect them very much, so we don't interfere with them, because these are wild lions. We would not be able to get close to them, and we would not be able to pet them at all, because they can be dangerous if you try to get too close to them, and if you cause them to feel afraid. And just like us, we don't like to feel afraid, and these lions are exactly the same. Now, there are not many lions in this area, and Dave, you want to know how many we see during a day. So at the moment, we've only seen these two. There is a pride of lions around, and Brent managed to see a glimpse of one female, I think, a bit earlier in the distance. Not easy to see. And this area that we are in at the moment, this part of this greater Kruger National Park in South Africa, there's many, many different lions, probably a few thousand lions within this greater national park, but it's very, very big. In this area we are, we only see, depending, around about 20 lions or so, give or take, with the different prides that come into the area, different families. So the one group and the family that Brent tried to see earlier, or was looking for earlier, there are five females and there's six little cubs. Now, unfortunately, they were across our boundary. We weren't able to get very close to them, but these males also part of a coalition of four brothers. So the other two brothers are probably just in another area patrolling a big territory, or what a territory is another word for their home, the area that they live in. And sometimes these lions will split up and move through different parts. And as I mentioned, the lions are saving energy, and Micah, you want to know why. So these lions are resting and saving the energy because they mainly move around at night. So lions like to move around, walk around, and possibly even hunt in the evenings. It becomes easier for them to move through the evening in the dark. They can hide away a lot better from animals that they might be hunting. And also it's much cooler, so it's much more comfortable to walk around. Just like we don't like to get too hot, it's the same with lions. On very, very hot days, they prefer to rest. And at night time, the temperature drops, so it becomes much cooler and it's better to walk around. It is really fantastic that we are able to sit so close to these lions, these beautiful wild lions. So Gavin, the lions hunt at night because it is easier for them to hide away. You can imagine some of the other animals around here in the pitch dark, and it can get very, very dark out here at times, it's difficult to see if there's predators or lions around. So the lions are able to sneak up very, very close to whatever animal it is that they are hunting, and that will make it easier for them to then get some food for the evening. So they would prefer hunting at night. But in saying that, the lions also hunt during the day. If there's something close by and if they see something that they would potentially try to hunt, they will try during the day. Doesn't matter if it's hot or not, because they don't know when their next meal is going to be. So if there's something around that they could possibly hunt, they will definitely try their best. It's very peaceful at the moment. There are some birds calling around us, some arrow-marked babblers. They've stopped now. And in the distance I can hear a few other birds calling. Just shows you how relaxed these lions are. And even though they look asleep, even if we had to step off this vehicle, and especially if we had to step off this vehicle, these lions, though they look asleep, if they stand up, they will react immediately. Katie, you want to know if the lions camouflage? Well, Katie, if you look at these colors, this brownish, this golden brown yellow color that these lions have, it's actually not that easy to spot them, especially when the grass gets a bit longer. Some of the grass in this area gets a beautiful brown color, so it can be much easier for the lions to camouflage in that. And trying to think if I've got a photo. Let's carry on looking at those lions. I just want to see if I've got a photo to show you. Vincent, you want to know, do little bugs live in the mane of the lions? Yes, possibly. Maybe little ticks. And those little ticks would definitely, and other little insects I'm sure will live inside that big mane. Now I found something I just want to show you. Give me a second. And if I can show you over here, Katie, just for all of you to see, I've got a picture of a lion that I took in another area, not here where we are. But have a look at that grass and that lion. Do you see that? Look how well camouflaged that lion is with that yellow grass, and blends in perfectly. So that will give you an idea of the lion's camouflage, and it all depends on the area that they are in. At the moment, these lions, we've been lucky because they're lying in the open, it's a bit easier for us to spot them. We're going to cross back to one of the other guides now and see what they're up to, and we're going to sit with these lions for a while.
Welcome, welcome to the African bush. Now, there's a very important bird in the African bush. It's called a white-backed vulture. It's like the trash collector. Eats all the rotting meat and stuff that's left. Now, that's actually two, and they're sitting on their nest. Now, somewhere there is a baby vulture. Oh. Is it though? That one on the left is the young vulture. It's grown up so quickly. It's been a while since I visited this nest. Now, you can see how the big vulture on the right is sitting with its wings wide open. That's because it's very hot here today. And when it's very hot, vultures do that. They open their wings. They've got blood vessels under their sort of what would be their armpits. So the cool breeze helps to keep the vulture cool. Oh, here we go. Having a yawn. That is the white-backed vulture. Welcome, my name is Brent. I haven't met you yet. I hope you guys are having a thoroughly wonderful school drive. Remember, ask us as many questions as possible. It can be about lions, it can be about leopards, it can be about vultures. Leopards and elephants are what Viam, who's on camera with me today, and myself are looking for. So we're very excited to have you. And of course, the wonderful thing about the African bush is there's literally something interesting everywhere you look. So hopefully we're going to find some of those things for you. So let's keep moving. Jacob would like to know, are there any hippos nearby? Indeed they are, Jacob. Not very close to me at the moment. Or you never know, if we get past one of the mud wallows, there could always be a hippo inside it. I'll keep looking for you, Jacob. But they are hippos, but they're only where there's deep water, where they can go down and submerge themselves in the water. Now, I heard a report that there was a leopard somewhere around here this morning, so that's what I'm looking for. And also looking for any birds or bugs or other interesting things we might find. Now, it's always good to pan carefully with your eyes while you're driving through the bush. Oh, what have we there? Aha! Aha! There's an interesting little flower. I'm gonna just zoop around where VM can get a better view. Now, this flower is called an abutilon. It doesn't have a common name, but it's an important flower. Oh, sorry. I just wanted to get a leaf. Now, pretty yellow flower. It always grows on disturbed soils, so area that has been, well, everywhere is quite disturbed. We've come out of a drought. But now, look how wonderful. And doesn't that look soft? Doesn't it look so lovely and soft? It's so soft, isn't it? Oh, it's so nice. Do you want to touch it, Vim? Here we go, touch it, Vim. It's so soft. So, when they get a bit bigger, there's a couple of things you can use it for. Now, you don't find many Walmarts or Quickie Marts or things out here. So sometimes you can use it for toilet paper because it's so soft when the leaves get a bit bigger. But more importantly, it's a bush band-aid. So it's also got some soothing sort of sap. So if you've got a big owie or nasty, you can put it on there and you can make a pile of them, and it works as a band-aid. It also keeps the wound nice and clean and stops infection. So an abutilon, the bush band-aid, or the bush loo paper. Now I wonder what else is around the next corner. Hello, Chloe. Chloe's asking, why were those vultures so high up in the tree? Well, Chloe, luckily enough, there's another vulture, so I can show you exactly why. So there we go. When we have a look, there's this tree here. You can see it's quite a tall tree, probably around 40 feet in height. And there's the vulture right on top, and it's another vulture's nest. Now, Chloe, a vulture puts its nest, well, white-back vultures are normally in knob-thorn trees, so that's a thorn tree. Now, it's got lots of very sharp hooked thorns, and they put their nests right on top. So it's difficult for other animals to come eat their babies. So it's going to be very difficult even for a snake to get that high to try eat their babies, or a lizard, or any other animal that's going to try eat their babies. So that's why they put them so high, and they always put them in very thorny trees. There we go, you can see that. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to get a bit closer, and I'll stand next to the tree. Now, let you know how tall I am. How tall do you think I am? I'm only joking. I'm 6'3", just under 6'4". So, is that close enough, Vim? Can you get the whole tree from here? There we go. Let's just go a little bit. And Debbie, I'm going to answer your question now. So there we go. You can see the whole tree. So I'm just under 6'4". So I said it's probably about 35, 40 feet. You've got to be careful. I don't want the vulture to have an accident on me. So there we go. You can see how big and tall this tree is. Look at that. Very big tree. And let me find some of those thorns to show you. But Debbie, you were wondering, are vultures decomposers? They are not, Debbie. They are what we call scavengers. A decomposer is normally an insect or an arthropod, like a millipede, or wood lice is a good example of a decomposer. And they break up normally vegetable matter. A scavenger will eat meat that's been left behind. Okay, let me just put my ears back in. And I'm going to pop that over there. Now, that's an old branch, so it's not a fresh, young, strong branch, but you can see there's these ones, those are the ones. Now, they're really sharp and vicious. Now, they would, it's stuck in my finger, but and that would help. Even a snake, when it's very thick like that, it's going to battle to slide between the thorns without hurting itself. So it's a very good place to put your babies, where they're protected from the other predators. I mean, you can see, I'll show you now. This is how much I like you guys. I'm going to show you how sharp these thorns are. And so you put it in there, and look how it lifts my skin. Owie! So very, very sharp thorns. Fortunately, I've got skin like old leather from being in the bush my whole life. But there we go. Off we go. I wonder what else is around the corner. Now, it always pays to look very, very carefully around. You never know what could be there. Now, speaking about things hiding and why you have to look very carefully, let's go see what's happening with Jamie.
Trees out here are very, very important, and Brent's just been showing you one type of tree. Now, I am hiding behind another, and this particular type of tree is called a buffalo thorn, and it's a very, very important tree out here. Now, in one of the other South African language, Afrikaans, this tree is known as a wachabiki tree, and that means, literally translated, wait a bit. Wait a little. And the reason it's called the wait a little tree is if we have a look at the thorns here, and let me try and find you a branch that we can break off. I'm going to cut myself. I've learned from experience that you don't necessarily touch this particular tree with great enthusiasm. The reason it's called a wachabiki tree is, or a wait a little tree, is that if you walk into the thorns, you're going to stab yourself, and then the hooked thorns are going to grab onto your clothes and onto your skin, and they're very, very sharp. You saw Brent poking thorns earlier. Now I'm doing the same. They're very, very sharp, which means that they cling onto your skin, and you have to wait a little before you leave. Now, a lot of the trees out here have a very, very important role in everyday life. Now, if you were a child here in South Africa and part of the sort of the local community which is outside of this reserve, if you were a child here, as soon as you finish school, this is a gift or a tree that your parents would give you. And the reason they would do that is it's symbolic. So the straight thorn represents the fact that you must go. You must go live your life. You must go have fun when you're young and when you've just finished school and you're going to university or to college. The hooked thorn, the one that curves backwards, is a reminder that you must always come back and visit, must always come home and remember where you come from. And I think that's a really beautiful lesson, don't you? A really nice gift to give someone, rather than a car or money or whatever it happens to be, a gift to remind you to live your life, but also never to forget where you've come from. It's also quite yummy leaves. And there's lots of trees with thorns out here, which we generally try and dodge. And poor Eggsy, for example, has now got to figure out how he's going to, whoopsie, get around the trees. That's very bitter. Very, very bitter tasting. Now, I'm looking for one particular type of tree that I can show you. And I think we've just come out of the area where they grow, because, of course, certain trees grow in certain places. But I've spotted something else that I want to show you. Remember those termites we were looking at earlier? We're looking at the termites, watching them collect all of their food. Now, there's different species of termites that we get out here. You get those that pull all of their food underground, and then you get the termites that build these. And that is a termite mound. And can you believe this termite mound is almost just the tip of the iceberg? That's only a little bit of the whole termite's home. Most of where they live is underground. But they build these enormous towers, and we're going to go a bit closer. Come and have a look. Remember how small those little insects were when I put my finger next to them? Those termites made this, something that small, over years and years and years. And Isaiah, while we're talking of the different insects, you want to know if there are any red ants near us. So we don't get the same fire ants and the same species of ants that you do on your side of the world, but we do get ants that bite just as painfully. We get an ant called a pugnacious ant. I don't know if you know what the word pugnacious means. Pugnacious means that you go for something and you don't let go. You're very pugnacious, you're determined. And that's exactly what pugnacious ants do. They grab onto you with their jaws and they won't let go. They just hold on and they hold on and they hold on. Even if you're shaking your foot and shaking your arm, they're still holding on and biting. And as soon as one bites you, the rest of them come, because it starts secreting a type of hormone or a type of smell that tells all of the other ants to come rushing to them. So you end up going like this on the ground. Luckily, there's none here. And in fact, there's no termites out here either. But isn't this just amazing? To think that something this small, something less tinier than my fingernail, something tinier than my fingernail, made this whole massive termite mound that's probably in height nearly 3 meters, which is about 9 feet in the air. And it's taken them a long time, and they've done it by digging, combining the dirt with their spit. I'm not going to combine the dirt with my spit now, because that's kind of gross, and packing it all together like building mud castles. Except they've built this over years and years and years. How amazing is that? Now, Shania, you want to know what termites eat. Shania, have you ever found yourself or heard of people in wooden houses having a problem with termites? They eat wood. They're one of the few creatures that can properly start to break down and digest even old and rotten wood. And sometimes it's even, let me show you something, sometimes it's even in a pile of dung. This came from an elephant. This is an elephant's poo. It's an old elephant poo, but it's an elephant's poo. And the reason it's got all of this dirt around here, Shania, is that the termites have been breaking down what the elephant didn't manage. So all these bits of grass and wood, this is what the termites are feeding on. And termites are really, really clever, because there are certain parts of the wood that they can't break down, but somehow they know that there is a type of fungus that will help them break it down. So, you know, like a mushroom or some mold on a piece of bread, the termites know exactly which fungus will help them to break it down. So what they do is they farm that particular fungus. How amazing is that? Like farmers growing crops, the termites do exactly that. So underneath the ground, there'll be these chambers where the termites are creating the fungus and then bringing them food, and the fungus breaks down the food and then the termites can eat it. But fungus only grows at a certain temperature. So the very clever termites, that's why they build these enormous turrets. And if we have a look, this one's a very old one, so I think all of them are closed. But usually in these termite mounds, you can see chimneys. It's exactly like a chimney in your house. Chimneys coming up from deep underneath the ground. Let's go around and see if we can't see one. And that, basically what they can do is they can open or close the termite, the turrets. They will open and close the turrets in a way that it's like you opening or closing a window to cool down underground or to make it warmer if it's a really cool day. How amazing is that? Ali, you want to know how a termite mound gets so big. And what I'm doing is I'm looking to see if I can see the beginnings of a termite mound. And unfortunately, I can't. So Ali, years and years and years of termites building from... It'll just start from scratch. It'll start on a patch of earth just like this one. And then there'll be lots and lots and lots, thousands and thousands, more termites than you can even imagine, all coming together, all working for a very specific reason. So they're coming and building up the walls of their termite mounds and just putting mud and spit over and over and over again all through every single night. And eventually, years later, you get something this big. Now, they are a truly amazing thing, these termites. Unfortunately, there's so much more that I wanted to show you, but it seems as though we have reached the end, and you all, of course, have lessons to go to, for which I'm very sorry, but I do hope you have a wonderful day further. I'm going to carry on my walk, but bye-bye, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us.
So we're still sitting with these lions. And they haven't really moved. One has turned over onto his back. Look at that. He's lying on his back and breathing quite heavily. And they do that when they're very hot. To try and cool themselves down, they pant quite quickly. And you can see that male over there. He looks a little hungry. His stomach isn't very, very full. Now, we mentioned earlier how the lions possibly do have ticks that sit on them. And Caden, you want to know if the lions ever get sick from the ticks. Caden, there may be some diseases that the lions can get from certain insects and from ticks, and it does affect other animals in certain areas. I personally haven't seen lions affected by a tick bite, but it can happen. I know that we, for example, if ticks bite us, we can get some serious diseases from them. But just like ticks can affect some other animals, I'm sure they would be able to affect the lions. But a lot of these animals do build up an immunity, which means they build up a resistance against these little bites from these insects and from the ticks. So I'm sure that these lions would probably be okay if any ticks do bite them for too long. Dara, I have not seen a lion cub being born, and the reason for that is when the females give birth to the little lion cubs, they go and they find a space or spot where they can hide away, so that if they give birth or when they give birth, they can hide those little cubs away from any danger, because when the little cubs are born, they're completely blind. So they're helpless, they can't move around, they need to be very careful. So the lions will look for an area that's very, very rocky, or perhaps in thick bushes that other animals can't get into. So the chance of us seeing that are very, very slim. I've never seen a lion give birth, no. And I don't know of anybody that has, other than perhaps in captivity, in maybe a zoo, but not in the wild. And you can see, is there a little tooth sticking out there? Just a little bit on the side of the lip, the edge of a tooth. And those teeth are very, very sharp and very large. And Gavin, you asked how sharp exactly. Well, put it this way, when they do feed on carcasses and they feed on animals, then they use those teeth to tear the meat. So they are very sharp and very, very powerful. But not quite as sharp as a knife would be, for example. Well, everyone from Providence Elementary, I hope you've enjoyed it. Thank you so much to all of you little children for sending us your questions. It's lovely to have your questions and comments, and it's so nice that you got to see these lions with us. Goodbye to all of you, and I might sit here a little bit longer with these lions. While we do, we're going to head back to Brent and see what he's up to.
We've got a lovely herd of kudu, and welcome to all our regular viewers. Oh, Vim, to the Nyala quickly. He's trying to make himself more impressive to the ladies. There we go, watch how he's gonna dig into the mud with his horns. Now we're in front of Arethusa Safari Lodge. I haven't been here in such a long time. We decided to come have a squiz. There's a little puddle of water. And there was some kudu and Inyala taking advantage of it. Gotta love an Inyala's orange socks. Okay, having a drink. Oh, there's a little three-banded plover there as well, just behind the Inyala. It's been quite hot today, around 80 degrees Fahrenheit. It is cooling off nicely at the moment. There we go. Oh, look, he's erected his crest. There comes another male. Don't look like there. Ooh, maybe they're going to have a little dance off. Nah. Obviously no female and estrus to keep them entertained. Absolutely incredible how dry it is. Not a drop in the main section of the dam. VM's going to show you now. Look at that. There's just a buffalo and a hippo carcass. And if we have a look, I think, where is it now? There, in there, I saw some monkeys moving. And some guinea fowl as well, it looked like. Yes, some guinea fowl on the ground. Where are the monkeys gone though? Just saw a monkey leap off. Anyway, well, we can't see them, they must have moved off. We're gonna do the same. And it's been nice checking around Arethusa. Unfortunately, no big cats just yet, but still nice to check on the lay of the land. It's been an age since I was last here on this particular area of Arethusa. Who knows, maybe we'll get lucky and have a bit of shadow luck. That's a leopard I haven't seen in a long time, a shadow. A lovely little drive through here along the edge of the safari drainage line, or river system, and lots of wonderful trees, thickets, so we might get some good birds. Remember, this is 100% live, so we literally don't know what's around the next corner, and pop me a question by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or use the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Eeny, meeny, miny, mo, four ways to go, but I think we're going to go the one that sticks closest to the river. Oh, but before we do, oh, there we go, don't fly, don't fly. Which one have we got? Let's have a look. Turn your head towards us so we can see whether you are, oh, a Clip glossy starling. No, it is a greater blue-eared glossy starling. See that very dark patch behind the eye? And the cape lacks that. Oh. A greater blue-eared glossy starling. Very noisy chaps. Now, I wonder if we can find those monkeys I saw from a distance. They might be moving through into this area. Where are your monkeys? There, some guinea fowl. Let's just get a bit further forward for you there, Vim. Can hear them tap, 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 tap. It's our bush chicken. About the same size as a chicken. Bit prettier there. With its spotty feathers and bright blue head with its red crest. So we're on this little track that runs right next to the dry riverbed, which is very, 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 used to be a very, very favorite area by Shadow, but as I say, we haven't seen her much. Hello, Patrick. Patrick would like to know if the helmeted guinea fowl is the bush version of a turkey. What is the bush version? Of a chicken. What is the bush version of a turkey? Well, size-wise, a ground hornbill, although it is behavior-wise nothing like a turkey. Oh, maybe a Cory bustard or the black-bellied bustard. They might be the bush versions of a turkey. Now I hear a very distinct bird call for a very pretty bird. Let's see if we can spot him. Calling high up in this knob thorn. What spook fall? Oh no. In the thickets right up the top. It's always a great place to look for birds in these riverine areas. And leopards, of course. One of my favorites. Okay. There's some beautiful little, beautiful flowers. Now, if we were planning to go anywhere near a carcass today, I'd definitely come collect some of these. Now, these will attract sunbirds, lots of different insects. Absolutely gorgeous. It's wild jasmine. Now we've got two different types here. One is a creeper. This is the creeping one. And it makes a great garden plant. You can plant it on your walls and it creeps up the wall. And during the summer months, your whole house is covered in this absolutely exquisite smell. Okay. Keep hoping to spot a leopard. Now, Melinda was asking about the helmeted guinea fowl and that bright red crest. Does it serve any purpose? Well, when you've got bright colours on birds like that, and particularly on something that's very prominent and sticks out, and if you think about a rooster and its crest and its wattle, it's generally all to attract the girls. The guys who've got the biggest and brightest crest are the guys who generally get the best girlfriends. Now, guinea fowl have quite a different sort of a system to chickens, whereas one male rooster will cover multiple female chickens. Guinea fowls will pair off in pairs, so a male will go with a single female, and they'll move away from being in a flock and to breed. So there we go, and that's probably one of the bigger differences between chickens and guinea fowls. Now we're going to keep moving through Arethusa, start slowly heading back towards Juma. While we do that, let's go see how Jamie's faring on foot.
While Brent goes on through Arethusa, Herbie has found me a puzzle, which is basically the equivalent of doing a jigsaw puzzle out here in the bush. Maybe not quite. It's got a few less pieces than your average jigsaw puzzle. But essentially what we're playing now is Build a Scorpion from the scorpion exoskeleton that Herbie found underneath this rock. Now, they're fascinating things, scorpions. I actually really, really like them. You can see what kind of a role, or just how sort of solid each and every little segment is within their tail and within their bodies. Now, of course, the fascinating thing about all arthropods is the fact that they have what is known as a hemocele, which is essentially an open blood system. So they don't have veins and capillaries and arteries in the same way that humans do. They just have this massive open cavity, which one can understand in a sort of a small scorpion like this, but becomes even more impressive when you imagine something much bigger, a scorpion the size of my hand, for example, which we do get out here and we do see on a relatively irregular basis. I'm not going to focus for too long on him because this is a particularly uncomfortable patch of ground for poor Eggsy to try and maneuver, but let me lift him up to try and show you. Oh no. No, come here. Let me try and make this a little bit easier, and let's go up so that we can really closely examine exactly what it is I wanted to show you. Now, scorpions have a unique mating dance. This one is obviously very deceased, and not recently either. This is a very, very deceased scorpion, but look here. Look really closely at those fine feathered fringes, and that all plays a part in a scorpion's mating display. The pectens were that well developed is what immediately tells me that this was a male scorpion, which is something I did not know until Steph told me, and it's amazing the vast amount of knowledge that he is able to impart. But here's the story, and here's how it works. When scorpions come together to mate, the male has to tread a little carefully because scorpions, as a rule, are not really the most social of creatures. I'm going to pop this one down because you've got the picture of those wings, and then we'll discuss it in a moment, but let's just pop them down for now. So scorpions are not the most social of creatures. They don't like each other's company. So when the male approaches, he's got to be decidedly careful that the female's not about to eat him, much like spiders in a way, and mantids. And he walks up and he does little taps with his legs. Of course, he's got legs on either side of his body, and he does a complicated little rhythm known only to that particular species of scorpion. And they can dance around for a while until eventually he realizes, okay, this female is now happy with me. So what he does is he goes and he clasps her with his pincers, grabs her. Now he's got to find an appropriate point to stop. So what he does is those pectens that sit sort of here on his abdomen, they flap down and descend. So imagine I'm a scorpion now. I mean, it's a little difficult. Okay, we're slightly different in shape. But he's wandering along. He's got this female in his claws. And he's wandering along looking for an appropriate patch of soil. When he finds it, a suitable flat, not too sandy, perhaps not too clay, not too wet, whenever he finds what it is he's looking for, he deposits what's known as a spermatophore, which I don't know exactly what it consists of, but I know obviously it contains his sperm, and then a sort of a straight upward facing, it's a sort of a spiky thing that he deposits, and it's probably made from solidified fluids or something similar. But he deposits the spermatophore on the ground, he's still got the ladybug pincers, and he picks her up, and he pops her on it. And as soon as her weight hits it, it bends and it releases the sperm. At which point she can stay there, they can stay clasped for a little while, and then all of a sudden they separate and they start jabbing viciously at each other, and sometimes, woe is him, much as it is with mantids and with spiders, the end, and he gets eaten. Not always, sometimes he escapes, particularly if it's a nice big male, but a lot of the time he does actually end up as a meal. Now, that is probably not what happened to this poor scorpion, but now you understand what I was saying. These feathered things here, try and control my caffeine shakes. But these feathered little bits here, that is what feels along the ground in order to work out exactly where to place his spermatophore. Fascinating creatures. And the mating rituals of arthropods, whether they be spiders, I'm not looking for a spider, just perhaps, perchance, whether they be spiders or anything in between, are usually quite fascinating. They're usually quite a complex thing. And I've been fortunate enough to witness one or two, and it's such a pity that we don't see more golden orb webs. These massive webs across like this. And they have to go and sort of, the males have to go and play the web very carefully in exactly the right rhythm so that the female spider doesn't eat them. Now, James Dungan, you wanted to know, don't they do a tail thing as well? Yes, certain species do. And certain species can also create a vibrational hiss. I'm not sure exactly how they do it. I think it's carapace-based, so it's, you know, the outside edge of their abdomen. But I think somehow they create a sort of a hissing shiver that they do. And that is a way of... Ooh. That is a way of attracting their ladies. Look at this. There was a bug on this earlier, but I'm actually looking at the spider's web that's on it and wondering whether we can't find the spider, just to continue our discussion of arthropod mating rituals. It seems empty. I don't know if you can see. Can you see the fine filaments there, Higgsy, of this web? I don't want to break it, obviously. Now, it will be underneath this web. Somewhere down here in a cavity in here. Oh, hold on, there it is. Found it. Don't want to smash your web, mister. Oh, it's not alive. It is a deceased spider. Ouch. And this is a thorny tree. It's a deceased another exoskeleton. My goodness, Impala Plains is just providing us with all the exoskeletons at the moment. Another spider. Again, a species in which the male has to be exceptionally careful of perhaps picking the right moment, and probably, preferably, not when the female is very hungry. Right, on that note, I'm going to go off in search of something else, preferably not exoskeletons. Perhaps we can find some live things. While we do, let's go across to Byron.
So we're still sitting with these lions, everyone, but they are still resting, hardly any movement, just the odd turn over or roll, and still enjoying the heat, enjoying the shade, because it is so hot. And I'm thinking that these lions are not going to go anywhere anytime soon until it starts cooling down. It's very humid, very muggy. You can hear that beautiful red-chested cuckoo calling in the background. You should hear it. Beautiful call. It's definitely one of the calls of summer, I think. I really do think so, because as soon as it starts getting hot, we seem to have I had a small technical issue there quickly, but we are back. As I was saying, these lions are resting in the shade because it is still so hot and very, very muggy. And I don't think they are going to move anytime soon, but look at those sharp teeth. Isn't that incredible? Very, very sharp incisors. They use those mainly to tear open carcasses, but when they do actually feed, they use the back teeth, the molars and the premolars. And that's where all the power is, at the back of the jaw, and they'll be able to chew the meat a lot better and tear it with those back teeth. But they will tear open carcasses with those front teeth. And I was chatting earlier about this red-chested cuckoo that's calling, and it hasn't stopped. Except now, it's just stopped. There we go, it started again. A beautiful call, and one of the calls of summer. I think they do return back here for the summer. And got a beautiful call, and you hear them constantly. They're very tricky to see though, very shy birds, but you do hear them. And these cuckoos are all over, different cuckoo species, but that red-chested cuckoo is such a distinct call. So what I'm going to do and what I'm thinking is I'm going to leave these lions for now because they are resting and I don't think they're going to move anytime soon. We're going to drive around a little bit, see what else we can find. Who knows? But and then probably try and return to these lions a little bit later and maybe they'll be a bit more active and who knows, maybe a roar. So while I move out of the sighting with these lions, let's head to Brent and get an update from him.
Yeah, we've just noticed that there's a female impala who's away from the rest of the herd. We're just trying to keep an eye on her. Now, normally when impala give birth, they do move a little bit away from the herd. I'm just trying to see any obvious signs that she might be coming into labor. And you can see she's very pregnant. But I'm not seeing any obvious signs of labor just yet. But she's not ruminating, she's not feeding. The rest of the herd are quite far away. Well, not quite far away, 100 meters or so. She could just be lost. So when female impala are ready to give birth, they do move off from the herd into some thickets like this. I'm just waiting to see. Wouldn't that be incredible if we managed to capture a baby impala being born? It's the right time of the year. Let's try go back a little bit. There she is. So what we'll be looking for her to have her legs to be splayed a little bit, but I'm not seeing any obvious signs just yet. Now I was telling Vim this morning, the first impala birth I ever saw, I must have been about 5 or 6 years old, and I was sitting on the front of a motorbike that my dad was driving. So on our family farm. She's moved off now into an area we can't really see. I'm just gonna just stay with her for a little bit longer. I don't know, I've got a hunch, a feeling, even though she's not showing any obvious overt signs of labor, just try to keep an eye on her through the thickets. She is heading back towards the rest of the herd. Oopa! Okay. look carefully now. She moved into these quarry thickets around here. And we lost sight of her there. You see her, Vim? Vim thinks he spotted her. I can't see her just yet. Further back, further forward. Now, okay, no, we're not going to be able to follow. Just try. Is she going into the drainage line? Okay. So Emma's wondering, why does she move away from the herd when she's so vulnerable? And how long does the birthing process take? Well, Emma, the reason they move away is because obviously a big herd's easy to see. If she's by herself, off hidden, less chance of a predator finding her. And it's not a very long birth. It's probably 5-6 minutes at the most, unless there's some complications. No, we can't see her. Oh, there she is. Actually, we've spotted her again. But we're going to lose sight of her. I think she might just be a little bit lost. Okay, bye, Impalala. Okay, we're going to keep checking down towards the southern end of the Arethusa airstrip while we do that. Let's go see what Jamie's up to.
We have got the tiniest, tiniest scorpion I think I have ever, ever seen. Look at this. Oh, goodness, I'm actually too scared to get too close to it in case it runs away. This is such a tiny scorpion. It is only, I don't know exactly how old it is, but this is relatively newly. It's okay, little one chap. I don't want to scare it. This is relatively newly hatched. Look at it compared to the size of my fingernail. Hmm? A little bit closer there. Closer to the scorpion. Shall I go any closer to the scorpion? Just remember, of course, that like baby snakes, baby scorpions hatch well equipped and capable of stinging and carry just as potent a venom as the adults do. Now, I cannot, at this size, tell you what age the scorpion is or what species the scorpion is, but it is a truly fascinating thing to see. And, of course, scorpions for arthropods are actually relatively good mothers. They will carry their little ones around on their back in the first few stages or the first few days and weeks of their lives, depending on the species. They'll carry them around all clustered on their backs in the most amazing, and it's one of my dreams to find you that on one of these bushwalks. A female scorpion with all of her little ones clutched on top. Now, I'm carefully checking around to see whether or not there's any sign of the others, perhaps the rest of this particular brood. All that we've found, though, is the exoskeleton of what could be the mother, but that, I mean, that's a big assumption to make. But another exoskeleton, but this little one is alive and well, and immediately makes me think of a story from a book, a wonderful book that I grew up on, called My Family and Other Animals. Now, seriously, if you would like to enjoy a good read, it is by Gerald Durrell, and it is an absolutely fascinating. Look at this little thing. I can't stop looking at it. It is so cute. And I'll go into a moment why it makes me think of My Family and Other Animals. Those of you that have read it will, of course, immediately know what I mean. But before we do, just to discuss the development and the life cycle of a baby scorpion in its first few days of life, they go through what's called as, is it ecdysis or ecdysis, it's ecdysis. And basically they molt. They don't change shape. It's not like one of the other things, like a tick, for example, or perhaps a dragonfly, or even a caterpillar that goes through different life cycles and metamorphosizes into a different life form. In the case of scorpions and spiders, they molt, and they just get bigger and bigger and bigger, and they shed their exoskeleton, and they grow a new one. They are, of course, incredibly vulnerable at this stage, but they do most of their molting and shedding in the initial stages of their life, and once they get bigger, like snakes, then they shed less and less often because they don't grow as fast. Now, the story that I'm thinking of, while I lead you to my next point, of call, which is a completely different kettle of fish. The story that I'm thinking of, and my mom always loved this book, and I think it's because she identified with the ordeals that Gerald Durrell put his family to. Though I, of course, did not grow up on an island called Corfu, I certainly came home with all manner of strange things and birds' eggs and always wanted it one pet or another. But there's one wonderful moment where Gerald Durrell, as a little boy, puts a female scorpion with all of its babies on top of her in a matchbox, and somehow, I can't remember how exactly, but his family goes to one of the family members, opens up the matchbox, and this mother lands on the table, babies everywhere, mother frantically running around to collect all of her babies and get them back on her back, sister screaming, I remember his sister's name was Margot, so sister screaming, mother screaming, and sort of putting up with all of his stuff. And it always makes me laugh because I imagine that's something that my mother had to put up with when I was a child, though not quite as bad. And I imagine Brent's parents even more so. I grew up in Johannesburg. I grew up in a city. Brent did not, so you can just imagine what he put his parents through. Right, quickly, just to show you this patch of dug-up ground. This has all been done by a porcupine. How do I know it's a porcupine? Shape of the digging. And the presence of, wow, that's a long one. Look how long this porcupine quill is. How cool is that? The presence of the quills and the digging. Right, Jerry's put in the request. Now, I just want to show you one thing quickly, if that's all right, that is related to the porcupine. Porcupines, of course, are the biggest rodents in South Africa. And look at this mark here. That is such a clear incisor scrape. That's been done by the porcupine targeting the root. So you see those, you know how rats have those rat teeth or mice teeth? Porcupine have exactly the same thing, those well-developed, powerful incisors. There's the gap between the two of them. And the porcupine has done this. The porcupine's gone like this. Scraped with its teeth, with its front teeth. So just some interesting things that we find. I'm going to grab the quills and take them back for Jerry. In the meantime, let's go over to Byron, see what he's up to.
And we've just found a vervet monkey, and very strangely, only one. I can't seem to see any others. I'm joking. I've just spotted the rest of them. They're just off to the right, moving it under the trees. You might get a glimpse of some of them walking around. And there we go, there's one through there. So a little troop of vervet monkeys, and further right, but they're very, very shy, and they do hide away from us. It's not always easy to see them. I'm going to see if I can maybe move forward a bit, maybe get you a better view. And if you look, I'll show you now, but just off in the playing under these marulas, a whole bunch of them, and there's one. You might get through there, Gendre. There's two or three walking about, and there we go. Lovely view of one with his leg up, relaxing. they are funny to watch, I must admit. And there will probably be one or two up in a tree somewhere. I wonder what that one got there. That was interesting. I didn't see what that was. While they're walking around, they're foraging for food, looking for fruit, certain insects perhaps, and some, or maybe even certain plant material that they will feed on. Ah, there's one that's probably going to come into the picture. It's a little bit further right, Gendre, as almost where that there is going over there, but it's got a baby under the belly. So let's just see. You should hopefully be see it soon. Come on. There we go. Look at the little baby. Isn't that incredible? Oh, wonderful. Hanging on to its mother. That is so cute. Wow, that is tiny. That looks very, very new. That is very special. That is lovely to see. Look at that. Oh, just sitting with her back to us now. And as I was saying, there's probably one or two sitting in a tree somewhere keeping lookout for any potential danger, potential predators, and monkeys have incredible eyesight, so they are very, very alert of what's going on around them. There you can see quite a few of them moving through the thicket. Michael, you wanted to know if what's more relaxed, the vervet monkeys or the baboons around the vehicle. Now, Michael, to be honest, I would have to say I think I don't know. It varies on the area that they are in. If they're feeding, if they're in a tree, the baboons are probably a bit more relaxed. But walking like this, the monkeys are keeping their distance from us. Make no mistake, they're not coming close at all. But they do seem fairly relaxed. They do know that we are out here. But they're still on the ground foraging for food or feeding, looking for food. So it's actually difficult to say, Michael. I think it would depend on the situation, depend on the area, and the specific group of monkeys and baboons, how relaxed they are with vehicles in general. It's starting to get a bit harder to follow them. They are moving through or deeper into the bush. But what a wonderful sighting, such a nice surprise. Just walking along, feeding. And what a special treat to see that little baby hanging on to its mother. As I said, oh, there they go. They're just moving off a little bit further. So we're going to carry on now. They've just moved off, and so let's see what else we can find. But it's very difficult to see them now. They're moving behind those branches. James, you want... and then as they get a bit older, it starts darkening. I'm not entirely sure at what age it begins to darken, but I've seen very early on, so young monkeys, young vervet monkeys that are not even a year old, already the faces started to change and become a lot darker. But I'm not exactly sure at what point it is, but it's definitely within the first year it does start to darken. It's actually a lovely cool breeze now while we're driving. That is really, really pleasant. And a nice start to the afternoon already with the lions. That was a great treat. The monkeys. And we'll see what else we can find. Oh, it's a beautiful little bird. Let me just see if I can show it to you. Gendre can get it. There we go. A little bee eater. Look at that. Oh, and there. Oh, where's it going? Hang on, it might to fly off behind us. But at least we got a view of it. A very quick but beautiful view of the little bee eater. Now, I just want to show you something quickly in my book with these bee eaters. There are many different species that we do get around here, but they are all very, very colorful. And they're wonderful to see. So let me just show you some of them that we might be seeing around here at the moment. And let me show you the little bee eater. Actually, lovely light now too. So that is the beautiful little bee eater that we just saw. And you could see that yellow throat very, very clearly. And unfortunately, these books don't do the birds any credits. I mean, you could see, or any justice, you could see that bird was much more colorful in real life. Let me just show you some of the other ones that we might see. And this is another one that we're starting to see at the moment, this beautiful European bee eater. Also a bit of yellow under the throat, but this is much larger, and that almost turquoise blue under the belly. And slightly reddish brown on top, rufous on top. But like I said, these pictures over here do not do them any justice. And those are just two of the bee eaters that we might get around here. Also get the carmine bee eater, that beautiful reddish pink, or mainly pink color. And they are wonderful, wonderful birds. Now they do something very interesting. And we saw that little bee eater perched on that branch. So the bee eaters in general have this behavior that what happens when they are looking for food, they usually feed on the wing. So they'll fly around, and the term bee eater doesn't mean they specifically feed on bees, but they feed on insects. What happens is they'll fly down, sit on a branch, and then they use a method known as hawking. And what it is, they'll fly around, they'll do a loop, possibly try to catch an insect, and then they're often return to the same perch and they'll feed on whatever it is that they've caught, and that's known as hawking. So the bee eaters are known for doing that type of behavior. But wonderful to see the little bee eater. Denise, a secretary bird on safari live. You'd love to see one. Now, I'm not sure if they've seen one before. You have. Okay, so Jandre says you have. Because they do occur in this area. They definitely occur in the Greater Kruger. And the chances are good. Chances are good. So they do occur around here. But I haven't seen one yet in this area. But just further south, I've seen many secretary birds. So they do occur in this area. I'm just trying to see her. Big elephant track. I'm trying to see which direction it's gone. And let me try to show you. Just to show you how we gauge which direction the elephants are going. Can you see down there, Jandre? Yeah, that's a bit better. All right, let me jump off quickly and show you. Sure, still very hot. Okay, now I'm just having a good look so I don't make a mistake. So what's happened is, this is a very large elephant. I'm going to try to show you here. It's probably clearest over here. So if I draw a line around the track like this, you can see that is a big, big track. And this elephant, it appears as if, and I just want to make sure, yeah, definitely, it's walking down the road, so in that direction, away, well, the opposite direction to what we are going. And I can tell that because there's a very distinct mark in the front of the track around here. So what has happened is the elephant, as it puts its foot down and it moves forward, it kicks up some of the sand. And I'll demonstrate that for you. If you watch, if I had to walk, this is what it would be doing. So as it's walking, it steps, and when it moves forward, it drags the foot a little bit like that. Do you see that? So you can often see the little drag mark. And over there, sorry, Jandre, I'm jumping around a little bit, but I'm sure you're getting all of this. And that's a clear sign to see which direction the elephant tracks are going. And these are really, really clear. They're not from too long ago. Well, during the course of the day, because, and I can tell that because there are vehicle tracks that have driven down the road, and these elephant tracks are on top of the vehicles. So during the course of the day, but it could have been anywhere between this morning's game drive and this afternoon. So, well, this morning's safari rather, and this afternoon, but it would have been a big, big bull. I don't see tracks of any other elephant around here. It just looks like the one. Trying to just hear, you never know, we could possibly hear it breaking some branches. But it's quiet. Just some, I can hear European bee eaters, funnily enough. They're flying above us, they're very, very high at the moment, but I can just hear the call. Oh no, actually, that's not. I'm trying to do the European bee eater call, but I can't. Alright, so we're going to continue moving along this road, seeing what else we can find. Let's head back to Jamie on a walk and see what she's got.
We're strolling around there. Strolling around? So I don't know what's happened to my ability to speak the English language today. I apologize. We're strolling along, making our way towards that vast open area. Sort of, for those of you who are familiar with the geography, this is the road known as Impala Road, and over there is Sandy Patch and the main access road. And I'm making my way towards this huge open area, and I'm actually traveling along the road for a reason. Because a couple of days ago, I had the most incredible dung beetle sighting, and I'm sort of hoping we can have a repeat of that. I feel as though this afternoon is very much a... No, it's a tree, not an elephant. Very much a small things kind of a walk. We haven't encountered any... Ow! Stick! Thorns. We haven't encountered much in the way of big game. And in fact, I think the only animal I saw was an impala really far away. But I am really thoroughly enjoying the littler things. From the termite mounds... This isn't a very good termite area. From the termite mounds to the various scorpions... to this massive impala midden. I shouldn't really stand in the middle of it, but you've got impala dung of all ages here. Fantastic. Ah, hello to Lindsay. Lindsay, yes, I did happen to look up the species of the gecko last night. I haven't fully finalized what I wanted. So yesterday, ooh, nice track. I'm going to show it to you in a second. Yesterday, we spotted a gecko that popped out of a hole on a marula tree, and Lindsay sent through this amazing message that she was on species number 100, except that I didn't know which gecko it was. So Lindsay, I did go searching, and I can tell you what it isn't, but I'm still trying to narrow down exactly what it is, and I'm going back through the screenshots, thank you, by the way, to all of you for sending them through. There's certain identifying features of geckos, particularly their toes, you know, the ones that I'm trying to look at. Don't stand on my track. There's particularly the ones, the sort of the aspects of their toes. You get the fat-tailed geckos. I think, Lindsay, it could have been a tropical house gecko, because you get so many different variations of color out here that it's not really like identifying a bird where you page through your book and you go, oh, that's what I just saw. It's a little bit more difficult than that, because snakes, reptiles, geckos, certain spiders, certain scorpions, they all come with different color variations in different parts of Africa and even different parts of the Sabi sand, for example. So I think it might have been a tropical house gecko, but I'm still working on clarifying. Let me just show you this track here, since I did just instruct poor Etty not to stand on it. This is our track. That we can do. Now, this is hopefully, well, not hopefully, but this at the moment is the closest we have come to a hyena. Crescent shaped toes, kidney bean toes on the outer ends, and of course those really lovely peculiar shaped back pads with only two lobes at the back. And if you look really closely here and here, those are the indents from the claws. And it's an old track, it's not a fresh track, unfortunately, so it's an old track, and in fact we can't really, there's the front foot, this is the back foot, there's the front foot, but it's only a portion of it. It's been jumped all over by wildebeest playing in the road. There are tracks all over here. Right, let's see what else we can find on the vast open area. Oh, hold on, let me just see if I can't find us a dung beetle. Oh, my head did a little bit of a whirl there as I stood up too fast. I'm so desperate to have a dung beetle on bushwalk. And I've been so unlucky so far, I just haven't had one. No. Now, Tanis, you wanted to know what fruit trees we have here. Voila! The magic gwari is one of them. Now, magic gwaris, unfortunately, this isn't gwari berry time. Gwari berry time. This isn't gwari berry time. So they don't have any fruit on them at the moment. The one that's about to come into fruit is a tree known as the marula tree. And that is very exciting, because marula fruit, hands down, there is no competition. Marula tree fruit is the best fruit. Now, we're not in a good area for marulas. So I can't show you one right now. We're just in the wrong sort of vegetation. You don't really find marulas and gwari trees in the same sort of thickets all that often. A marula fruit is about the size of a golf ball, give or take. And the elephants love them, so we have to get to them before the elephants do. Just take one or two and wait for them to ripen, and before the monkeys and the squirrels. It's the sweetest, sweetest juice. And what I like to do is crush it into a pulp without breaking the skin, and then bite the skin, because the skin's not really that great, and then you suck out the juice. It's incredibly high in vitamin C, really, really good for you, and really delicious. That, of course, is where Amarula, the famous Amarula liqueur, for those of you that have come through on safari, goes in coffee or enjoyed on ice or whatever, however you happen to drink it. One of our biggest, It's one of our big exports, made in Palabora, which is not too far away from here. Marula trees, jackalberry trees, Bushman's grape. I ate one the other day. It was revolting, but you can eat them. What else am I forgetting? Jackalberries, whiteberries from the whiteberry bush. Don't eat the seeds though, because it'll make your head go all funny and feel a bit woozy. But there's a whiteberry bush. Here we go. Ha ha. Okay, we will not be eating these yet, but this is a whiteberry bush, believe it or not. And, you know, because we're very imaginative when we name things out here, it is called a white berry bush because when the berries are ripe, they turn... Eggsy?
White.
Yes, they turn white. Hence the name white berry bush. So these are not good to eat just yet, but white berry bushes are quite nice to eat. Oh, I thought I'd stumbled upon a marula, but alas, I had not. I would have been quite surprised. So whiteberry bushes, don't eat poison apple, which comes from the tomato plant. That has very nice, delicious-looking berries that look like little miniature tomatoes. The name poison apple kind of gives it away. Don't eat those. You got to be careful, because some of the things out here are toxic, and we don't want to eat them. But jackalberries, all sorts of things. And if you find yourself, here's a Bushman's grape. Let's see if I can find a fruit on here as well. Ah, you would be the one Bushman's grape without a grape, wouldn't you? Oh, that reminds me. Raisin bushes. Raisin bushes have these tiny little, and when they start to get ripe, they look like raisins. Kind of like the white berry bush, but in this case, a raisin bush. And you get different species of them. You can eat those as well. They're pretty average, to be honest. Baobabs have... Ooh, I'm not going that way. That's got some thorns on it. Baobabs have the nicest fruit, but unfortunately, we don't really get them here in this part of the Great Kruger. You'd have to go a little bit further to the north. There are a couple of them around Hoedspruit, a couple of them around Zanine, although I think the biggest one actually got struck by lightning recently. But there's lots and lots of berries. Here's another Bushman's grape. Does it have berries? Drum roll. Yes, it does. Here we go. There we go. Bushman's grape. I'm not going to eat that one. I have learned my lesson, Eggsy. No, he's learned his lesson too. I made him eat the last one and it was not very nice. Last question from Vera. Before we send you across to Brent, you want to know what the national flower of South Africa is. It is the Protea, which is a type of flower that you find in the Fynbos region of the Western Cape. Very, very unique type of flower. That whole plant system, which is known as the Cape Floral, sorry, not system, kingdom, the Cape Floral Kingdom, a lot of them are propagated by fire. They actually need fire in order for the seeds to germinate. Quiz for you very quickly. National tree of South Africa. I'll give you a hint, it is not a marula or a baobab. And in fact, we don't find them on Juma. But what is the national tree of South Africa? And on that note, while you ponder that, go over to Brent and see how his scouring of Arethusa is doing.
Well, Vim and I have not had much luck when it comes to animals on, or birds for that matter, on this sunset safari. We have literally covered the whole of Arethusa and couple of Duyker, a couple of Stenbok, a couple of Impala. We've now decided to do the opposite. We've moved all the way down our southern boundary. Karula is in Little Gowrie. And we've now on our eastern boundary. Vim and I decided we haven't been down to Cheetah Line in so long, we might as well go have a squiz. And it seems like Jamie was talking about flowers. Oh, I think I'll look for some wild flowers now. and maybe a butterfly or three. Oh, I saw a very difficult one. Okay, Vim, on the yellow flower. You got the yellow flower? The three yellow flowers, right there. Okay, now that is a Chorus aspinifolia, but that's not what I spotted. Look at that. Oh, it's a difficult butterfly. Come on, crawl a little bit. I need to see your back. I think I know which butterfly that is. Now, I haven't done a butterfly in a day or two, so there we go. Thank you, Mr. Butterfly. Now, open your wings. It's one of the blues. Tiny little blues. They are one of the harder species to identify, and there are many hundreds of little blue butterflies. Now, when identifying blues, this is an African grass blue. Now, hopefully it'll open its wings and you'll be able to see. Oh, there's an ant underneath them there somewhere, yes. But that's an African grass blue feeding off the beautiful little chorus flower. Come on, open your wings. So on the inside, it's got sort of a very dull, dun grey border. But in the middle is a very, very pretty lilac blue. Oh, now we just need him to open while he's facing this way. Very delicate. Oh, you might have got a flash of blue there, but I can show you what he looks like. Yeah, the African grass blue. There we go. The bottom one. Now, quite often to identify a lot of these butterflies, you're looking at the outside because their wings are often closed when they're sitting still long enough for you to identify them. And we notice there's no eyes, there's no little rackets, and that very distinct spotty. Not like the dotted blue, which we saw a few days ago, which is that one up there. You can see much more dotty, much more prominent spots, and it wasn't that one. So it was the African grass blue. Vim, do you have a pen by chance? I don't know. I've just realized this is a checklist, so we can actually check and write when we saw them, so we can keep track of our butterfly list. No pen? No pen. Maybe in my box, probably not though. Okay, I'm gonna have to remember to get a pen or a pencil to bring with me, so we can keep a track of our summer butterfly list. I think what are we on now? We've got the African grass blue, we've got the dotted blue so far, and now, our final controls think they're very funny. Now, I can tell you why they think they're very funny. So, as a lot of you know, Jamie and I recently got engaged and we've bought a house. And when we first moved into the house, I wander around the house with my phone talking to Siri. Siri, remind me to get number 12 spanner. Siri, I need to get this from the hardware store. Siri, I need to do this. Siri. So final control says, why don't I get Siri to remind me about the butterflies, or remind me to probably just get a pen to bring with me. So funny final control. Siri is a very useful tool. Just because you don't know how to use it, it's not my fault. That's why I don't forget anything on my town trips, because I have Siri. Okay, we'll keep looking for some more flowers, and hopefully we'll get some new ones. And we've got a bit of time. Oh, there we go, there's a new flower. Well, new for this year. Those little white ones. There we go. That's an anthericum. Very pretty. Unfortunately, not much interesting information about an anthericum, apart from the fact they're very beautiful and they attract butterflies and bugs. Now, there's quite a few different species of anthericum, and some of them can actually be sort of 2 foot high. This one is not one of those. This is one of the smaller ones. But very, very, very pretty nonetheless. Okay. That's the wonderful thing about the African bush. If you open your eyes and look, there's always something to look at. Okay, now, these are not flowers yet, but you see these stringy bean things. A little bit to the left, there's another chorus, but there we go. Those are gonna be crinum lilies, but I think we need a little bit more rain for those lilies to pop out. So hopefully they do pop out soon. We have seen some of them, but they only flower for a very short period of time before they disappear. Highly, highly poisonous sap on the crinums, so you'll be very careful when you, well, you shouldn't be handling them, but if you want to handle a crinum lily, you better be careful. Now, the other reason I was hoping, I was taking cheetah cut line is because I'm looking for another first, and it seems to be one of the more popular areas for the European rollers. Now, we've seen them in between drives and off air, and we haven't managed to put one on camera yet, so we're hunting for the European roller as well in this area. But alas, the whole of cheetah cut line, not one European roller. Now, of course, the Nkuhumas are very close to the boundary, and we are slowly meandering back in that direction, hoping as it gets cooler they might get moving, and who knows, maybe they'll go on a hunt. I think we take a little dabble past Buffalo's Hook waterhole. I'm scanning for flowers and scanning for European rollers. Now, the woodlands are back in not quite full force yet, but we can hear them almost everywhere we stop at the moment. And unfortunately, they haven't been quite so forthcoming on camera, but as we know, as summer develops, we're going to be able to spend a lot more time with them. At Inga's house, where we live, there's a... I don't know what killed that. What was that? Okay, I just saw something there. It's probably a buffalo carcass. It's a baby buffalo carcass by the looks of things. So this one doesn't look like it's been killed by anything. It looks like it died during the drought of probably malnutrition. You can see the skin's mostly intact. It hasn't been opened up by something like a lion or a hyena. So poor little guy, just couldn't survive the drought. Well, let's move on. That's quite morbid. Hello, Riley, in Miss Jacobs' cast. Nice to have you with us, Riley. Riley's wondering, what is the most common bird? Riley, we've got quite a lot of common birds, but I'd probably say one of the most common is the Cape Turtle Dove, one of the dove species. Oh, we also got very common starlings. I'll try to find you some birds now, Riley. And of course, when they're everywhere when you're not looking for them, and as soon as you look for them... Oh, there's a wildly beast there. Don't run away, wildebeest. Where are you off to? Let me go forward. Where are you off to, Mr. Wildebeest? He's not hanging about, that chap. He's... Oh, wait there. Looks like... There we go. There's a herd of wildebeest, actually, in through there. Moving into some thick bush. One of the biggest antelope species we get here, and well, they had a cameo appearance as they disappeared. Sorry about that. They don't want to be on camera. They're camera shy today, guys. Okay. So we're going to go down to a waterhole. Maybe we'll get lucky. There might be a hippo there. There might be some birds around the edge of the water. There might be some antelope drinking. Who knows, if we're really lucky, there could even be a leopard there. Okay, now it's in our rainy season, and there's some big clouds building up. Hopefully we do get some rain. We've just come out of a very bad drought. There we go, you can see the clouds hiding the sun. Now, I've got a question for you guys. Now, let's see how clever you are. Who can tell me, and you must remember I'm tricky, who can tell me what is the biggest wild cat or big cat in the world? Why don't you tell me that? Let's see how clever you are. What is the biggest big cat in the world? Oh, we're nearly at the waterhole. Hopefully there's something there. course, this is live, and often when you watch wildlife documentaries, it's action, action, action. But you must remember, most of the time, those take a couple of years to make, whereas we are taking you on a real-time safari. So it's like you're sitting in Africa with me. So isn't that exciting? And sometimes when you drive around in Africa, you get to see a lot of trees and a lot of grass. James Robertson, nice to have you on the back of my safari vehicle. James would like to know, because it's the worst drought in about 110 years, and James would like to know, have we seen any of the big predators eating any birds? James, has actually been the opposite. They've been focusing on big animals like buffalo and hippo and kudu and zebra and impala. Where did that go? Oh, I saw a bird, but it was too fast for me. So no, James, they haven't been eating the birds. They've been eating the opposite. Now, if we had had lots of rain and it wasn't a drought and all the impala and things were very healthy, and we do see sometimes leopards catch, oh, I've seen leopards catch bird here, and it all just depends. And I must remember, all the predators are opportunists. So it doesn't matter, if even if it's a drought, if there's a bird that comes, was silly enough to get close, okay, there's a waterhole here that has been dry, but it's been filled up by the rain. So we're hoping that there's something there. Maybe we'll be lucky and there's an elephant, one of my favorite animals. See if I can smell an elephant. Ooh! Aren't you guys clever? Teresa, Lynn, and lots of others say the biggest is the Siberian tiger. Sure, you guys are too smart. So, do you think I can catch you? Should I try a trickier question? Aha. What is the biggest mammal in the world? What is the biggest mammal in the world? If you're not sure what a mammal is, of course, a mammal is a warm-blooded animal that has mammary glands, so the babies will drink milk. So it's not a snake, it's not a reptile, a crocodile, or anything like that. It is a mammal. Where are mammals? Oh dear. Well, we've come to the waterhole and, well, at least there's a bird. There's a few little birds. Oh, don't fly away, bird. Don't be naughty. Stay there. Where do you go? Oh, there he is. There we go. A very pretty little bird called the three-banded plover. It feeds off very, very small aquatic insects. And there he goes. So he's got big, wide feet so he doesn't sink into the mud. There we go. Oh, I'm looking for little aquatic insects to eat. So normally when he's eating aquatic insects, it's the babies. It's the larval stage of mayflies, dragonflies, and all sorts of things like that. Oh, busy little guy. Now, I was hoping there's going to be lots of other things here, but alas, it doesn't look like it. Just a little three-banded plover. So we're going to keep trying to find you some animals while we do that. Jamie is going to say goodbye. It's the end of the walk time, so let's go see her.
I'm going to say goodbye, but not just yet, not before I've shown you this incredible, what I think is the remains of one of the spider hunting wasps, if I'm not mistaken. And it's got the most incredible, and I'm just going to move around to the side so that I can see exactly what it is you're seeing. And to see whether or not you can see the iridescent sheen on the wings. Absolutely beautiful. I suspect that it is an ex-spider hunting wasp, and that stinger on the end of its abdomen suggests to me that we are correct in that assumption. Now, a spider hunting wasp buzzes around, as its name suggests. They catch and kill spiders, often large spiders, using their sting, and then what the female will do is she'll drag the wasp to a hole, and they've got very powerful legs that they use for digging, and they can actually excavate a hole in the ground, and they do it very, 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 very rapidly. And what they do from there is they will lay their eggs inside the dead spider, and they will bury it. And then when her baby's hatched, Mom has provided them with a ready-made meal. Seems as though we're not on a roll with live things today, are we, Eggsy? I found many, many dead things and one baby scorpion. And some live termites, actually. We did relatively well there. And since it is now time for us to start heading home, I'm always slightly wary of that antenna, although I have not been bopped in the head in a long time. Liss and Rob and many, many others got the national tree very quickly and very easily. It was indeed a yellow wood. Well done to all of you. I think we're going far too easy on you, making these quizzes far too easy. We're going to have to try harder. And Pamela thought that they made me wear an antenna in my cap. No, Pamela, it's because Jerry demanded, I tell you. No, I'm just joking. Jerry asked very nicely if I would bring the porcupine quill back to her. And how could I say no, especially since she recently gave me a very nice haircut. And since she is in charge of my haircuts in the future, I definitely would like to keep her on my good side. Lovely, lovely person. So, on that note, well done to Jerry for directing the show this afternoon. And thank you to all of you and to Eggsy. We're going to head home. A big thank you to Herbie. We'll catch up with you on the Sunrise Safari. Until then, bye-bye.
Okay, so not much happening at Buffalo's Hook Waterhole. We're going to keep heading to the west, see if the Nkuhuma pride has woken up now that it's a bit cooler, and maybe they'll start moving back onto Juma. Fingers crossed. Now, you never know what's around here. Now, we're going to keep looking for wildflowers and flutterbys. I was really hoping to find some ellies, but they seem to have vacated during the day. Oh, you terrible bird, you flying away thing. Well, that's the one thing. We can't make them sit, can we? Well, much as we would love to. Okay, so this area seems to have slightly less rain than Cheetah Cutline. Now, it's not unusual for the rainfall in an area to be very patchy because of the way we normally get our big rains and thunderstorms, so certain areas will get a lot more than others. And when looking for wildflowers, you want the area that's had the most. And here you can see it's quite a bit drier and no flowers. Maybe when we get up to the crest, maybe there's been a bit more rain there. Hopefully there has. Okay. Anything down in the dry riverbed? Alas. No, and we shall continue on our endeavours. Remember, this is 100% live. You are able to ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive or the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Well, I better start looking ahead. There's a car on the way. Let me just move out of the way. Of course, there are lots of other vehicles around for those of you new. Hello, Tom. Hello, Pats. How are you guys doing? Very well, thank you. Nkuhuma is still lying in the same spot. I'm hoping they come back the side. Two males, and I just checked out. And we're doing wildflowers and butterflies now. Well, when there's no big cats, we've got to find something. Yes, very nicely. We'll chat to you later. Bye. So there we go. That's Tom and they're from Buffalo's Hook. They have a lodge there, so they're out enjoying the African wildlife. Well done, Roger, Sia, and Denise, and many, many others. I thought I'd catch you up and you would say the blue whale. Now, quite interestingly, talking about whales and elephants, you think, well, apart from being big, there's not much connecting them. Although it looks like, depending on what you look at, that the original ancestors of elephants actually came out of the ocean, and that's why they were able to develop such a massive body size. I have been doing a bit more research into that, so I will keep you updated once I understand or know a little bit more about that. But it seems like the original ancestors of elephants came out of the ocean, and that's why they enabled them to grow so big. So still no flowers up here, but I know where I can find some, so we'll head there. Sounds like the Nkumas are still flat cat in a Buffalo's Hook. We could just see the belly of a sleeping lioness. Maybe we'll take a swing past there, have a look, just in case. Oh, they've decided to get up. What have I spotted? It is the first wing-seeded sesame of the year. You got them there. Am I too close for him? Let me do that. Where is it? Oh, I can't see. There we go. The flowers are not even open yet. There we go. That is a wing-seeded sesame. Now, always an interesting one to check once the flowers open. And you can find aphids being farmed by ants on this plant. And the seeds you can actually crush to get an oil that can be used for cooking and all sorts of things. So it is closely related to the sesame plant that produces the sesame seeds. But this is a wild one, and unfortunately it is a perennial, and it's very difficult to cultivate. People have tried in the past to cultivate it as a commercial crop, but have failed dismally. Hi Sarah. Sarah says, I couldn't watch all of the sunrise safari, but did you find your wild dogs? Unfortunately, Sarah, it was a false report. It was misinformation, bad intel. So it turned out it wasn't wild dogs at all. There were wild dogs, but they were a very, very long way from Arethusa or our Traverse area. So unfortunately, it didn't. Hopefully they pop up for me this afternoon. Okay, now of course I spoke a little bit about on the sunrise safari, we're expecting the great deluge, the second great flood over the weekend. We're battening down the hatches, can you believe it? We've already ordered sandbags just in case, because if we get what's predicted in a day, which is 120 millimeters, I'm not sure what that is in inches, but it's a lot. We could be in for an interesting weekend. We might be doing more swimming than driving or walking. Just looking at the sky, trying to see if there's even a bird up there, but there isn't. Has been quite a quiet safari for Vim and myself, but we think it's because the Nkumas are waiting to treat us just now. That's what we think, don't we, Vim? Mm-hmm. And we've suffered in silence. Now we're hoping that the Nkumas come back across. Oh, Andreen It says, what is the world's largest living carnivore? Well, Andreen, see, now that could be a trick question, because theoretically, it's going to be a whale as well. Probably a killer whale. I'm just trying to think about my whale knowledge. It's a bit rusty. No, I haven't committed to killer whale just yet. Okay. What do you think, Vim? Killer whale?
Yeah, but it's not the blue whale eat, isn't it? Like?
Well, that's phytoplankton, so it's... see, you could say blue whale, but is phytoplankton meat? It's microscopic. Lots of arguments.
Does the killer whale outweigh the great white shark?
It does. Killer whale is much bigger than a great white shark. Now, let's just make sure we're not making any mistakes here. Sperm whale, which outweighs the killer whale and is a carnivore, hunts lots of different things. Let me just think about that for a second. Sperm whale, I think it's, Andreen, I think it's sperm whale is the biggest. VM's nodding his head in agreement, is the biggest carnivore. That was close, we nearly made a whoopsie. Now I'm waiting to hear, Andreen, were we right, were we wrong? There we go, Lindsay, who's a marine biologist who's watching. She says agrees, most likely a sperm whale. So I think we're covered there. We're in the right zone. Now it is incredible how diverse mammals are, and if you think about it, from a sloth to a human being or a gorilla to a sperm whale or a blue whale. Absolutely amazing how evolution has worked. And there's been so many different little failed branches on the evolutionary tree. And you can almost take it down to an engineer sitting at his designing board. Oh no, that one doesn't work. Throw it out. Start again. And even if we just look, take ourselves, human beings, for example, that we've actually given up quite a lot in terms of what we can do by being bipedal. Now, being bipedal has caused massive complications with birds. So, but evolutionary, it seems that there's a greater advantage to us being upright and with our forward-facing vision, to the complication that is caused by birthing with the narrow hips. Almost all other animals don't give birth through the hips; they give birth through the back. Even our closest relatives, gorillas and chimpanzees. So it is absolutely fascinating how evolution has decided that upright, forward-facing eye outweighs the risks that we have with birth. Okay, let's have a look what we got here. There's a Rexon. We're coming to check out the Incahomas again. Hello again!
Hello.
Nice to see you, M4. Still sleeping same place. Okay, I'll go for another loop. Cheers! Okay, the Incahomas have not moved a muscle. Can we see a bright belly there? I don't know if we can even see a belly at the moment. I think it was a bit further forward. Well, Andreen says the southern elephant seal. Oh, I think the southern elephant seal probably, it is one of the biggest, but I think sperm whale got a couple of thousand kilograms on him. Ah, there we go. Is that a head up there, Vim? You got them there. Through that quarry. Oh, we just can't see them. Well, the Nkumas, I can just see a head up through that quarry there somewhere. So just. Let me see where you're looking. I think it's a little bit further to the right. Okay, I'm just going to move slowly. We might catch a glimpse. of a lion through there. I can see them, but it's just trying to get the camera in the right spot. Oh no, head's gone down again. They've gone flat. There we go, there's a head up. There's a lion. Can't you see it? Oh no. You super zoom, I've lost it. There it is. There we go. There's a lion. Now, there we go. Now we're hoping the Nkuruma's come back to Juma this evening. So we're gonna hang around in this area. I'm gonna go loop-de-loop around. You can see there's another lion behind. Maybe one's gone for a drink. Let's check the big open area at Sydney's Waterhole. I just can't believe we literally have barely seen a living creature or mammalian living creature today. And Viam and I have covered some serious ground today as well. What do we got? Absolutely... No, it's not absolutely nothing. There's one wildebeest. At least one lonely gnu. Isn't that? There we go. That's all that's out here on the big open area. So I said we're going to keep looping in this area and keep checking on those Nkuruma's. Hopefully they are going to get up. Just to warn you guys, we're about to start another school drive in the next few minutes, so we will be fielding questions from the kids, and it is an incredibly important thing to be able to educate. Hang on, that's interesting. It's the way it's flying. What is that bird? What are you? It's quite difficult. It looked like a raptor to me. Oh, turn. I need to see your body shape. Oh, was that? Oh, well, I'm gonna try and catch up with that bird because that looks to be quite interesting. I've got a couple of hunches what it could be, and if it is one of them, it'll definitely be a new bird for almost everyone's bird lists. I'm watching where it's going. Oh, it's going far. Hold on tight. I do like my bird watching. Oh, there's a second one. That's even more interesting. I'm trying to catch up with them. Hopefully they're gonna land shortly. More than likely it's gonna be a more common species, but you never know, just from its body shape, I'm in the right family. But now I just wanna confirm whether it's the rare one or the common one. Please land. I can just make them out in the distance. Can you still see them, Viam? Oh, he's not stopping, is he? Well, anyway, it was a buzzard. It doesn't look like they're gonna stop. It was a buzzard, more than likely a common or a steppe buzzard that's migrated from the steppes of Russia to join us for the summer. I was really hoping it was a European honey buzzard. I have seen them in the Sabi Sands before, but a really long time ago, and they're not a common species in this area. Okay, so we're gonna keep on cruising, seeing what we can find. But while we do that, we're about to start a school drive, and let's go across to Byron so he can do that.
Welcome back, everyone. We're sitting with these lions, and a big welcome to Thoroughgood Elementary. Lovely to have all your little children with us on another school drive. It is great that you've just joined us. We're sitting with these two beautiful big male lions, and these are dominant male lions that patrol the territory in this whole area that we are situated in. And they actually part of a coalition of four brothers. Now, I'm not too sure where the other brothers are. They're possibly in another territory, which means another part of their home range. So lions have these areas that they patrol, that they protect, and they try and keep other lions out purely for competition. They don't want other big males around. And together, the four big males, they provide a strong front to keep other lions out. And it's so nice to have the young kids from Thoroughgood watching. It's always nice to have questions and get little kids interested in wildlife and nature. And it's lovely that you can join us on Safari Live all the way from your classrooms. So don't forget to ask your teacher to send in your questions. She can do that with Twitter at #SafariLive or email us questions@wildearth.tv, and we'll gladly answer your questions, and we just love hearing from all of you and your comments. And it's so nice that we're able to sit with these big males. That one's got his teeth sticking out a little bit. Look at that, very very sharp teeth. Now, Eliana, you wanted to know if these males have any cubs. So, Eliana, these males do have cubs that are with another pride, the Unkahuma pride, which we see regularly on Juma, which is where we are up in South Africa. And that pride at the moment, Brent was actually looking for them earlier. Brent is also out on safari on another vehicle. He was looking for them earlier. Unfortunately, he couldn't find them. They were just across our boundary on a neighboring property. And the cubs are there. There's six cubs at the moment with that pride. And these are the fathers of those cubs. But the fathers with lions, the big males, don't really look after the cubs very much. Sometimes they meet up with the families, but these males do move around a lot more by themselves. They don't stay with the pride, with the family of lions. That is up to the females to look after the little ones, or look after the little cubs. Mrs. Brewer, you would like to know how old the lions get. So, with males, males like this, possibly between the age of 10 or 12 years old. It does depend, though, on the area, on the territory, how much competition there is from other lions, how much food there's around. But on average, male lions live to about 10 to 12 years. Female lions may live up to about 15 years, 15 to 17 if they're lucky. That would be quite an old lion. But generally, lionesses do live a little bit longer than the males do. So maybe about 15 years. And that would be an average again. Ah, now, Nate, you've asked an interesting question. How often do the lions eat? So, Nate, what happens is these lions are very opportunistic. Now, that means that if there was food or some potential food that walked past and walked nearby, these lions would definitely try and catch or hunt and then catch that prey. If they feed on something very large, let's say, for example, a buffalo, there's a lot of meat there. These lions can eat for a day or maybe 2 days on that buffalo carcass. Then they won't have to hunt for another 2 or 3 days after that. But the thing is, and we've seen with these lions, that in the past, there've been a lot of buffalo around this area, and they've hunted a buffalo almost every day, which is unusual. But because the food is there and the chance to catch it, they will still try, because they never know when they're going to get food again. So I hope that answers your question, Nate. But if it's something small like an impala or anything like that, then it won't necessarily be too long before they will have to eat again. We're going to sit with these lions a little bit longer. Let's head over to Brent, who would like to say hello to you this evening.
Well, hello, hello, and aren't we lucky? Vim and I are surrounded by a herd of the largest land mammal in the world, the African elephant. Well, there's not the largest elephant, but he is very cute, a little baby boy. Oh, Mom, don't leave me behind, please, Mom. Now she's going behind us. Hello, my name is Brent. I've got Vim on camera with me, and it's great to have you with us. And this is wonderful. One of my favorite creatures to spend time with, the African elephant, and the gentle giants. As long as you treat them with respect. I'm just going to move a little bit further forward so we can see a few more of them. Oh, that one's going to do it for me. Move out into the open. There we go. That one's about 8-9 years old. They're all around us in the bushes. I'm just going to try and move into a spot where we can see more of them. Now remember, guys, please ask me questions. I'd love to hear from you, and I'll do my best to answer. And as I said, elephants are the largest land mammal in the world. They weigh up to about, a big elephant bull can weigh up to about 6,000 kilograms, which is probably around 14,000 pounds. So absolutely massive. And they can be about 16 foot at the shoulder, a big elephant bull. No big bulls here. This is a breeding herd. Oh, there comes some more. As I said, they're all over the place. Lots and lots of ellies, probably about 15 or 20 of them. There we go. That one's moving through there. And let's try and get close to the little baby again, who ran off because Mom forgot him a bit earlier. Oh, there he goes, running after Mom again. Mom. Look at that, isn't that absolutely wonderful? Mom is just sitting there going, what are you doing, child? Now, hello, Reese. Reese is wondering how long can their trunk be? Well, on a big elephant bull, about 3 meters, Reese. And these guys, it all depends on how old they are. There we go, there's one about 2 years old. And its trunk is probably about, what do you say, a meter and a half? You can just hear them moving through the bush all around us. Hello, Karina. Karina's wondering, how old are the mom elephants? Well, Karina, they're probably varying from anything from about, depending on the individual, 25, probably up to close to 50. Elephants can live for 65 years in the wild, and it's a very long-lived animal, almost the same as people. And the reason that elephants normally die is that they run out of teeth. They have a set amount of teeth over their life, and when they get very old, they're not able to break up what they're eating. There we go, let's just try to get back with the zellies. I'm just trying to get up ahead of them. Harper's wondering, how much water can an elephant drink? You can drink about 100 liters, which is just under 20 gallons in a day. Isn't that incredible? That's a lot of water. And a big elephant bull can eat up to about 450, 500 pounds of grass, trees, bark in one day. So they are always eating and almost always on the move. They eat for the majority of the day. Here we go. Hello, guys. Now, elephants are very big and they can be dangerous, but if you are careful with them and you respect them and you don't push their boundaries, they are very relaxed. And how we tell an elephant's relaxed is that we watch its body language. So, like, you can see when a person's upset, you can see when an elephant's upset. Now, the most important thing to look at with elephants is their tail. When a tail is sticking out and it's straight and it's rigid, it means the elephants are not happy. But when Their tails are loosely hanging. They are completely fine. And these elephants' tails are all hanging quite loosely. You can see they're actually moving towards us. Oh, there we go. Little guy shaking his ears. Param is wondering, do baby elephants have horns too? Param, I think you're thinking about tusks, which is an elephant's tooth. Oh, there we go. That's a little boy. There we go. That's the tooth. The babies do have, but they are inside. They have little milk teeth like humans do. They fall out. And then when they're about a year old, they start growing their tusks. Hello, mister. Now, that's a teenager. He's probably about 12 or 13 years old, that little boy. And there, those tusks covered in mud. These elephants have been having a nice mud bath to cool off before we found them. And see all the mud there. So the mud not only helps them to keep cool, because it's very hot here in the African bush, but it also helps to trap ticks and other parasites. Now Gage is wondering how elephants wash themselves. Now Gage, they don't. The rain will wash them. Generally they'll try and make themselves dirty. They'll cover themselves in mud on purpose. And you can see all the mud on them. Now they've got incredibly thick skin, so they don't actually need to be clean. And for an elephant, it's better to have mud all over you than to be clean. Oh, this one's coming closer to us, this little teenage boy. Hello, mister. He's probably about 8 or 9 feet from our car at the moment. Oh, we're being stalked from behind as well. There's another elephant. Now, hello. Off it goes. Now Michael's wondering how elephants make sound. Well, Michael, let's have a look. I was heard them talking. So what they do is they can trumpet out of their nose, which is basically like a big elephant whistle. And what else? Other noises. Oh, the baby's been forgotten again. Off he runs. Panic, panic, panic. Behind the bush, unfortunately. Let me go backwards a little bit. There we go. Where's my mom? That's not my mom. Sorry, and they do low rumbles from their bellies. And those low rumbles can be heard by other elephants for up to 10 or 15 kilometers. And a lot of those rumbles are very low frequency, so we can't hear them. We can only hear the higher frequency rumbles. And I've got an interesting fact for you about elephant rumbles. Now, if any of you have watched movies that have got dinosaurs in it, like Jurassic Park, all the sounds that they use for the T-Rex, and mostly for the T-Rex, are all slowed down noises that an elephant makes. So that's where they got all those sounds from. Let's catch up with these ellies again. So they're being quite nice, moving through some quite open areas. Here we go. Hello, Ellie's. Hello, Lucy. Lucy's wondering, are any of these animals in Virginia too? No, Lucy. All the animals that live naturally in the African bush don't occur in the Americas. Some of the birds do, like the grey heron, and you might get those in Virginia, but you're not going to get any elephants or lions or leopards. You've got your own animals in America, like cougars or mountain lions, coyotes and white-tailed deer. Jaguars in southern United States, Arizona, that area, Texas. Here we go. And these ellies are getting fast food. They're eating as they move, and they're about to move into some very thick stuff, but we'll stay with them as long as we can. Now, Now, Eliana's wondering if you can ride on an elephant. In certain places in the world you can, Eliana, but it's very, very bad. Because to make a beautiful big animal like an elephant able for a person to ride on it, you actually have to bully it. You have to be very mean to it, and you have to make it scared of you. So riding on elephants is not very good. It's not very nice for the animals, because you have to be very mean and hurt the animal to make it safe enough for a person to ride. So we don't like riding elephants, and if you had to try ride one of these elephants, it would squash you, because it's a wild elephant. Well, the elephants have moved off into the thick bush, and hopefully Byron's lions are going to start getting moving soon, so let's go back and see those.
And it does look they're going to start moving around. One has just moved a little bit and sat up. You can see sitting with its head up. The other one was yawning once or twice, and that's usually a good sign too, that they might get a little bit active. And I'm hoping, and if we're really, really lucky, these lions decide to roar for us. But I'm not sure. It's always difficult. There's no guarantee. And they will roar perhaps during the course of the evening and early mornings. We heard them roaring this morning all the way from camp. And that is just to warn other lions that this is their territory and that they must stay away. But for now, they're still just resting. But let's hope and wait and see. Maybe we get lucky and we hear a lion roar. Wouldn't that be wonderful? So, Karina, we can only get, I would say, about 4 or 5 meters, so a few yards away from these lions. We don't want to get too close. Sometimes, however, the lions, if they want to, they may get up and walk right past the cars sometimes. It doesn't happen often, but if they choose to, I would not try and get too much closer to them, because I would probably disturb them and they'd get up and move away. They don't like the vehicles very much, but if we parked and we are quiet and sitting still, they may get up and walk right past the vehicle. So that's probably as close as you can get, but that's because they have chosen to walk past us, and not because we have tried to drive up to them. Oh, Mackenzie, you want to know how fast these lions are and how fast can they run? So much, much faster than any of us can run. A male lion, or a lion, can cover about 20 to 22 meters per second. So to put that into perspective, let me think. Some of you may have watched the Olympics and you watched the sprinters. Wow, beautiful big yawn. Did you see that? You may have watched the sprinters running, and they run the 100 meter dash. And I'm sure you have seen that. So if a lion had to run the 100 meter dash, it could probably do it in about 4.5 or 5 seconds. Isn't that incredible how fast that is? The record is about 9 seconds, 9-point-something seconds from a person, from Usain Bolt. But a lion would run it in 4.5 to 5 seconds. So very, very fast. Cecilia, you want to know how sharp the lion's teeth are. And they, to be honest, they are quite sharp, but not as sharp as a knife would be. But they're very powerful and they can tear meat very easily if they are feeding on something. Hang on, listen. Oh, it looked like that male wanted to possibly call, but I think he was just had a little fur ball perhaps, or hair ball maybe. I don't know. So Cecilia, their teeth are sharp, but like I say, not razor sharp like a knife would be, but sharp enough that if they had to bite into bite into some meat. There's another yawn from that male. All this yawning is a good sign that they're possibly going to wake up and start moving around. Param, you want to know if the lions hibernate? So no, they don't. Oh, look, another big yawn. Wonderful. So Param, these animals don't hibernate here. They are active throughout the year. And all our animals, the mammals that we get in Africa, none of them migrate, none of them hibernate. They are always active throughout the year. So not like the bears that you get in America that hibernate. These lions will not hibernate at all. They're active all year round. Hudson, you want to know if we live close to the animals. So Hudson, our little camp that we stay at is right in the middle of this game reserve. So yes, we stay very close to the animals, and often we have the animals right outside our little camp. We are safe in the camp though, and we are always very, very careful around camp, but when we are on safari, we stay right in the middle, so the animals are always around us. Isn't that wonderful? It's very, very exciting. But we are very careful, and when we're in camp in the evenings, we are safe, so we don't have to worry about anything. Alex, and you've asked an interesting question. Now, I think your question is because you've seen these lions yawning or perhaps resting like this. So Alex wants to know, why are the lions so tired? Now, the yawning that we can see is actually the way the lions start waking up. And what they're doing is, while they are yawning, they are breathing in and trying to get oxygen into their body. And that helps them to wake up and become a bit more active. So they're not yawning because they're tired, they're yawning because they're wanting to wake up and get more active. But they have been resting during the day. And the reason for that, Alex, is because it's so very hot. And the lions prefer resting during the day when it is very hot, and then moving around at night when it's cooler. And the temperature is starting to drop. Just like we don't like to move around when it's very hot, you know, we feel tired and perhaps like we want to rest rather than running around in the heat. Same with lions. And then in the evenings, when we decide to all go to bed, the lions start waking up and moving around and possibly trying to hunt. Who knows? We don't really know, because we don't often get to follow them at night. But it's wonderful that you've joined us at... Oh, listen, listen, listen. Yes, listen, everybody. Isn't that incredible? Wow, I've got goosebumps, everybody. That was absolutely amazing. Such a wonderful, wonderful sound. And I promise you, even for me still, I'm so lucky I do get to see this. Not that often, but I have seen it many times in the bush. And still, it's an emotional sound for me. I get goosebumps to be this close to these lions and have them roaring like that. That was incredible. Wow, that was amazing. What a way to end off a day. And that's what we've been waiting for. We've been very patient. We spent quite a lot of time with these lions. We left them earlier because we knew that they probably won't move, or we thought they wouldn't move, and luckily we were right. They stayed in this area, and then we got this wonderful, wonderful roar. And they may do that a few times during the course of the evening, and that is again to warn other lions. This is their territory, this is their home. Other lions must stay away. And perhaps also to meet or find where the brothers are. Maybe the brothers will return the call at some point, and the brothers can be anywhere. These lions have a very big home or territory, a very large area, but they'll use that roar to communicate with each other. That was incredible. Wasn't that special? This is so amazing. Okay, I'm going to sit here for a few more minutes with these lions and see if they do decide to get up and move. Let's head back to my friend Brent quickly and see what he's up to.
The lions have just run all the So it's the females and the babies. They were hunting and they've just chased something, trying to find out where they went. There we go, there's a lion, but we've got some special stuff. There they are. We've got an infrared, because they're cubs, so we don't put spotlights on cubs. So we've got an infrared light. So it's going to be pitch black when we put it on. Is it sensored on yet? Yep. There we go. Look at that. So it's going to look a bit weird and green, but this is so we can follow animals hunting at night without disturbing them with all our lights. You can see her there, Vim. There, yeah. And she was moving through there. There's some more. There we go. You can see that that's a lion just through there. I don't know if you guys can make it out. Let me just check. The others should be moving through shortly. I saw some cubs, some baby lions. A little bit further back. There we go, there's a baby lion. Rex, I've got visual of them from... Okay. Let's just keep moving with these lions. Now they're out on the hunt, and they could be looking for lots of things. Now, hello, Mrs. Brewer. Mrs. Brewer is wondering, are lions nocturnal? Indeed, they are. They are most active in the hours of darkness because it's much cooler. Now, they have a big problem with heat dissipation. Oh, that's what they could have been chasing. I'm going to go up ahead. We'll come back to the lions now, but I think they might have been chasing these. We're going to put the VR again. Now, the reason we don't put... Don't worry, I just want to show you this quickly. Now, here we go, we got some impala there and some zebra coming up shortly. So I think that's possibly what the lions chased. I don't think they caught one. There, the zebra. I don't think they caught one because we would hear this very upset sounds. Or somewhere on this side. I'm just going to go back again a little bit. Now, you must remember, I can't see anything. I'm watching what you're watching. I've got a little screen in the front of my car, and that's what I'm watching, so it's pitch black. Quickly across to Byron.
Listen, everybody. Amazing, you joined us just in the right time. Another roar, isn't that incredible, everyone? Absolutely amazing. That was so wonderful. That was great, wasn't that fantastic? Sorry we took you away from what Brent was finding over there, but we thought you might want to hear this beautiful roar again from these lions. And again, just what an amazing sound. So, so cool. Param, you want to know if the lions have a herd. So no, they don't, Param. These lions, so as I was saying earlier, the males belong to a coalition of males. So this particular coalition of four brothers that we know move around together. But they do split up and move in different areas at times to mark their territory or their home range. But they will meet up with a pride of lions. So that's what we call a group or family of lions. It's known as a pride of lions. So there are prides of lions that move through these areas, and that's mainly the females with the younger lions. And every now and then these males will meet up with those females. So it's called a pride, not a herd of lions. So, Gage, you wanted to know if the lions crawl into grass to get their prey. So, not necessarily. What these lions will do is when they are off hunting, they'll use, and especially when it's dark, it's easier for them to sneak up on animals. They'll try and use the bushes and the grass that's around. At the moment, this area is very open. There's no grass for them to hide behind. But there are areas that are thick, lots of trees and bushes, and they'll try to hide behind those to be able to hunt the prey, whatever it is that they're looking for, perhaps a buffalo or a zebra, like Brent saw earlier. And these lions would then try and sneak up very, very close to the prey and then ambush and jump on them and hunt them that way. So they don't go crawling into grass or into thick grass to look for prey. They may use it to try and hide or sneak up, but purely because of their camouflage. Often the grass in this area gets a beautiful brown coloration similar to these lions, so their camouflage works and it'll help them hide away from the prey, whatever it is they are hunting. Eliana, interesting question and a funny answer, and some of you might laugh at this, but the male lions don't actually do the hunting. The female lions do. So these males are clever. They will try and meet up with the females occasionally, and especially when the females go off and hunt, they're very, very good hunters, and they will go and hunt for food, and then the males will just come in and eat what they have got or what they have caught. So maybe just like some of your mommies might cook dinner for you and your dad back home, sometimes the lions do the same. Females catch the prey and the males will come in and eat. But if it is something very big, if the male lions are with the females and if they see something like a big buffalo, sometimes the male lions will help the females and they will help and hunt. But in saying that, when these males are alone, like they are now, they will indeed hunt for themselves if they have to. So if something had to walk past, they will definitely try to catch it because it is food, and if they are hungry, they can't wait for the females. They will definitely try to catch it themselves, but they probably wouldn't share it with the females. You wanted to know if lions are like cheetahs. So no, they are not. The only thing is it's similar is that the cheetahs are also considered big cats. So they are part of the cat family, so technically they're related, but they're very different animals, Param. The lions are big, powerful predators, much, much bigger than the cheetah. Cheetah's much smaller. Oh, there's another big yawn. And Param, the cheetah is built for speed, so they run very, very quickly to hunt their prey, whatever it is. If it's an antelope in the open grasslands, they'll run very quickly to hunt their prey. Whereas the lions, as we mentioned, they would try to stalk, which means sneak up and get very close to their prey to hunt them. But the lions are much, much bigger and very different to cheetah. It looks like these lions are still happy to rest, even though they roared for us, and we're so lucky that we got two big roars from them. That was really, really very, very special. Now, speaking about prey and different animals that the lions hunt, Western, the lions do indeed hunt elephant. Not that often, though. Elephants are very big and they're very powerful and strong, so they can chase lions. And I've seen many times how elephants chase lions away. But in certain areas, especially in Botswana, which is a country just north of South Africa, there are lions there that have learned to hunt the elephant. There's a lot of elephant around, especially the younger elephant. It's a bit easier to hunt them. So it can happen, Weston. So Reese, the biggest or best way to tell the difference between a girl lion or a boy lion, or the male or female, is you can see these males over here, they've got this beautiful big mane on their necks. You can see that very hairy neck and head, and the females do not have that at all. So you can easily tell if it's a male or a female by that big mane. If you see them from a distance or lying down like this, the males have that beautiful big mane. I might sit here for a few more minutes. Let's head back to Brent quickly for an update.
Oh, unfortunately, the other lions were following. They went through some bush. We couldn't take a car in. So now I'm looking for some nocturnal creatures, little primates called bush babies. Maybe we can find a chameleon if we're very lucky. I'm hoping we will find a chameleon. Now, we can spot chameleons much more easily at night than we can during the day. So I'm checking very, very carefully on all the bushes. Hopefully we will find one. Oh, no chameleon there. No chameleon there. But what a wonderful safari. What a treat to have those male lions roaring. I am a little bit jealous, I won't lie. Now, for those of you out there, do you know what a male lion says? If you don't know what a male lion says, I'm going to have to teach you what a male lion says. So, what a male lion says is, whose land is it? Whose land is it? Whose land is it? It's mine, it's mine, it's mine. So he's telling all the other lions, quickly across to proper roaring.
There we go, everyone. Just when you leave us, then they start wanting to call again. Wasn't that incredible? So another roar, a third one for the evening. That is very, very lucky. I'm so happy that you got to hear that. We keep stealing you away from Brent, but something like this is not something you hear very often. So it is wonderful to be able to show you and for you to hear it. That is incredible. Isn't that wonderful? We're starting to get a lot of bugs around us at the moment. especially now in summer, there are a lot of bugs because of all the rain that we get. And with the spotlights, you start seeing all the bugs coming to the light. and you can see some of them flying about us. But wasn't that a wonderful, wonderful sound? Mrs. Brewer, you want to know if the lions purr like your pet cat? No, they don't. They don't, not at all. The lions have a very, very large voice box, and they've got a lot of cartilage and bone around their voice box. Sorry, I almost lost my voice there. Around their voice box, and they do not purr. The only big cat which does purr is a cheetah, actually. So it does make a purring sound, just very similar to house cat. Obviously, a much louder purr, but they do purr. The lions do not, and neither do leopards. Leopards also do not purr. Noah, you want to know if there are cheetahs around. We do see cheetah occasionally, but this area is a bit thick. Cheetah generally prefer very open areas, very open landscape where there's grassland, so it's easy for them to hunt. As we said, they rely on their speed and they hunt using that to run down their prey. But we do get cheetah in this area, but especially with these lions around at the moment, chances of seeing cheetah are very slim, because cheetah don't like lions, and if the lions had to see the cheetah, they could possibly chase them away. So in this area at the moment, there probably won't be cheetah, but in this greater Kruger area where we are, we do have lots of cheetah, yes. And a big yawn. Param, you wanted to know if the female lions have cubs, and at the moment the female lions do. Unfortunately, we couldn't show them to you this afternoon, but maybe on another drive we get lucky and we find them again. And the female lions do have cubs at the moment. They've got 6 cubs with them. Well, the pride that we see on Juma more regularly, because there are other lions around, but this pride, and these are the fathers, and those females do have little cubs at the moment, all 6 of them. We're going to stay with these lions a little bit longer. We almost finished. And I think on behalf of Brent, he says good night to all of you. Well, good night for us. But I hope you have a wonderful day. From Brent and Viam. Oh, a lot of bugs around. See, it's not easy in Africa, everyone. They have bugs, they're lions. A lot of creatures out here, which is wonderful. Thank you to everybody who joined us this afternoon for our drive, and especially all the children on our school drives that we had. It was wonderful to have you. A big thank you to the ladies in Final Control, Rebecca and Jerry. And again, thank you to Brent and Viam. Thank you very much to my friend Jandre on camera with me. And from myself, Byron, a good night and a lovely day to all of you. Bye-bye, everyone. We'll see you all soon.